afternoon, football fans, and welcome back. It is day number two of Three and Out, eight divisions in 8 days, and today we are talking AFC East. Yes, my brain is a little scattered right now because I've been interviewing millions of people, but it has been great so far. Oh my gosh, where's that applause button? This has been so much fun. Today we are talking about the AFC East. So many things to get to. Rodgers going to the Jets. Oh my gosh. And he's taking Lazard with him. How good is this Jets team going to be this year? The Patriots, have they fallen from grace? Or is it, as I always say, the Patriots are always going to be the Patriots as long as Bill is around. Also, the Finns. The Dolphins, there is reason to believe that this team is actually going to be very, very, very good this year. But it has to show on the field. Last year, they looked good, but how good will they be facing all the talent they got this year? It's a pretty stacked schedule, and let's just say there's a team in their division that is extremely hungry, and that, of course, is the Buffalo Bills. How good will this team be this year? Will they go all the way? Last year was just a year of, my goodness, whatever could happen did, unfortunately. But those Bills are here. They are ready to roll. And this team has so much going for them right now. This is going to be one fun show. It is one fun division. The AFC East is going to be probably one of the most storied divisions in the entire NFL this year, especially circulating around Aaron Rodgers, Bill Belichick. I mean, Tua, what will he do this year? As I said already, these Bills are here. They are in business. This is going to be so much fun, and I hope you guys are ready for the ride. So with that said, y'all, strap in your seatbelts because it's going to be a ride. You are now tuned in live to 3 and Out, 8 divisions in 8 days, AFC week day number 2, AFC East. Right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. Welcome, 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 football fans. Oh my goodness gracious, we have made it to day number two. Day number one was a blast yesterday. Once again, big shout out to everybody in the AFC West. Our boy Aaron, good old Aaron Yoel, Kale Henderson, Taryn Rodriguez, and Bishop. Great stuff yesterday talking Broncos, Raiders, Chargers, and Chiefs. And well, we put a cap on that. We have four teams down, 28 to go. And by the end of today, we'll have 24 to go. One division at a time. So glad you can be here with us today. And this is going to be a fun show. So with that said, you guys, big ups as always to the man above. For without him, nothing is possible. Just always got to say that. And big ups to all of you listeners out there. For without you guys, IE Sports Radio is not possible. Thank you so much for being here for another year, tuning in with all of these crazy interviews. As I always say, y'all, 3 and Out is such a big show. We need an 8-episode start-off, kickoff to the season. And it is always a fun time, always a pleasure. And I enjoy doing this, even though I'm brain-wrecked around this time, getting ready to go back to work, studying for these darn state tests and all that good stuff for work, getting all that done, just getting everything situated. It's a crazy year, of course, getting all these interviews recorded, 32 of these darn things in 2 weeks. But it's worth it. It is so worth it. This is such a fun time, and it's a great time of year. Training camp is here. All these fans, everyone is ready to rock and roll, and it is just a great, great, great time in the NFL. So really quick, got to give a big shout out to our sponsor, man. Big ups to Planet Jerky. Planet Jerky is absolutely delicious. Premium brisket jerky. Planet Jerky, of course, is the official jerky of the 2022 California League champion Lake Elsinore Storm, which is the single A affiliate of the San Diego Padres. This all brisket jerky has gluten-free options, contains no MSG, no sodium nitrate, low in sugar, and high in protein. This is some of the best jerky you can get your hands on. I'll tell you right now, if you run on over to planetjerky.net and place your order and let them know, of course, follow them on Instagram at Planet Jerky. Let them know that you bought the jerky listening to this ad. You're entered in a raffle, and if you win the raffle, you either get, if you're in the Lake Elsinore area or if you are in Southern California and you want to see a great championship baseball team, you can win 4 tickets to see the Storm, or if you're somewhere else in the country, or hey, even if you don't want to see the Storm, you get 4 free bags of jerky. So please make sure to follow Planet Jerky at Planet Jerky on Instagram. Great stuff there. Delicious jerky. That raffle will conclude on Tuesday, August 1st. And yeah, I guess once again, big ups to our sponsor, Planet Jerky. This is a delicious jerky. Trust me. And it is a jerky that is on a whole other planet. Oh, it's good stuff. So make sure you want to go grab a bag today. And make sure you head on over to the iSports Radio store as well at iSportsRadio.com. Use the promo code IESRSummerSale23 to gain access to our 10% off. We decided to extend it because we did so well in that first week. Head on over to iSportsRadio.com. Check out the new merch while it's still there. A lot of it is gone, but go check it out. Grab you something. Definitely appreciate you supporting the station. Lots of shirts, hats, Razorback tank tops. Got a sweatshirt in there left, I think. One long sleeve and a few hats. And just make sure you go check it out. Show us some love. We appreciate you. And of course, iSports Radio has been around for the last 9 years. My goodness. Can't believe it's been almost 10 years, but we've been bringing you amazing content, ranging from interviewing legendary athletes, coaches, and our authorized media personnel, to building tailor-made dedicated to all major sports cities around the country. Please make sure to give us a follow all over the place, Twitter or X now, I guess, Instagram, Facebook, all at iSports Radio, as well as TikTok. Check out our website once again, iSportsRadio.com. Show us some love, you guys. We appreciate you all. Check out our merch. And thank you guys for making iSports Radio your direct feed for all that is sports. So with that said, you guys, we appreciate you all so very much. It has been an amazing start already. Once again, we are 1 day in to 3 and out, 8 divisions in 8 days, AFC week, and well, day one concluded with the AFC West, and here we go on to day number 2 with the AFC East. As I said earlier, you guys, the Pats, this team is still they're still the Pats, you guys, because Bill is still there. I solemnly believe that. I've been a football fan for as long as I've been a real diehard football fan. The Patriots have been amazing. I'm talking about in the early 2000s, you guys. You know, I'm a Raider fan, so the Tuck rule, you know, it was a fumble. But what I will always say is you can't knock their success. They have, you know, arguably the greatest quarterback of all time, one of the greatest dynasties of all time. Pay respect where respect is due. They're in a little bit of a slump right now, but can they fight back? Can they get back? Can they climb that mountain? The Finns, they seem to have their number. They seem to have the Patriots number every single time they come to town. But will these Dolphins, they have a sleeper team right now. They are low-key pretty damn good. If they get it together, how good can they be? How far will they go? Taking a look here at the Jets. Yeah, you got Aaron Rodgers now. They're signing so much talent. They brought Lazard over. There is a lot of talent floating around the New York Jets right now. How well are they going to be? How well off are they going to be? And talking about, you know, a team that is well put together, surrounded with tons of talent, the Buffalo Bills, you guys, this team is no joke. They got more talent than you can shake a stick at. Their draft was incredible. I mean, it was awesome, and you'll hear exactly what I think about the Chiefs in a little bit. But we got ourselves a busy show. Let's have at it and have some fun. And here we go. Without further ado, y'all, let's go ahead and get on into... Oh, well, by the way, before we do that, I skipped this yesterday because I'm just so excited and there's so much more. But head on over to 3 and Out. That's at 3 and Out, all spelt out, at 3 and Out, IESR, okay? And check out our voting poll. You can scroll down a little bit. You'll see the voting poll down there. Let us know who you think is going to win the AFC East this year. Right now, currently leading, thank you to everybody who has voted. The Buffalo Bills right now are leading with 42%. Then we have the Miami Dolphins with 26%, the New York Jets with 24%, and the New England Patriots with 8%. Head on over. Let us know who you think is going to win this thing, because that voting poll will be done close to the near the end of this show. And I will, of course, read you the final results of what you guys think and who you think is going to win the AFC East. So let us know. And there it is. So we got so many great guests coming your way today. And, well, let's get to it. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let's get to all these awesome interviews. This is me, your boy Larry B, and I will see you guys in just a bit. Until then, enjoy the show. Once again, you are listening to 3 and Out, 8 Divisions in 8 Days, AFC Week, day number 2, AFC East Day, right here on IE Sports Radio. Your direct feed for all that is sports. When we come back, we're starting things off with our boy Mikey Two Guns of our bleeping city here on IE Sports Radio. Great show every Wednesday evening. Make sure to catch him tomorrow. But we're starting things off in Foxborough with those New England Patriots coming up right after this.
What's good, everyone? It's Drewski, the host of Heart of Texas Sports on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. On this station, we cover everything in the Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas area. From where we cover the Dallas Cowboys, the Dallas Stars, Dallas Mavericks, Dallas Wings, Texas Rangers, TCU, SMU, we cover it all right here. Every Wednesdays from 9 to 10 p.m. Central Time. Make sure you stay live with me on the Heart of Texas Sports on IE Sports Radio. Your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Davidson.
It's your boy, Darius Lock.
And we are the hosts of Fast Break here on IE Sports Radio, where we discuss everything in the world of basketball, from prep to the pros.
You guys should definitely check us out, man. Sunday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We got all the basketball information you guys need, so we look forward to you guys listening in.
And please do, because we are the best basketball show on this side of the Mississippi. And please do check us out on Twitter at FastBreakISR. D-Lock, where's our time again?
8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Again, you guys spending time on a Sunday.
Tune in.
Welcome back, football fans. Well, here we go. Day number 2 of AFC Week continues to roll on as we are now in the AFC East, and we are getting ready to lead things off with none other than the New England Patriots. And here to help me talk about those Patriots, he is a newcomer here to IE Sports Radio. And what do I mean by newcomer? Not necessarily new to the show, because he has his very own show here on the network, and we're glad to have him, but just this year, and he has already made splashes I'm glad to have him here. He is the ideal, and I'm talking about ideal Boston fan you want for your network to host your Boston show. He's as humble as can be, but at the end of the day, he's got some of that Boston arrogance, and I would too if I lived in Titletown and those were my teams. But I'll tell you right now, he is a humble, yet he's got that chippy, arrogant side that says bring it on. And on top of that, he'll tell you what he really feels about his team. And the best part is he'll tell you how he really feels about your teams as well. Ladies and gentlemen, glad to have him here to talk about his New England Patriots. He is none other than the host of Our Bleepin' City right here on IE Sports Radio. Give a warm bleepin' welcome to the one, the only, Mikey Two Guns. What's going on, Mikey? How you doing today, brother?
What's happening, my man, Larry? Man, it is such a bleeping honor to come on your show to talk about one of the most, to talk about the most successful franchise in the NFL, the Patriots, 6-time Super Bowl champs. It is such an honor to come on your show. I also want to say, extend my gratitude for bringing me into the IE family. This has been so awesome. Every Wednesday, 7 to 8, our bleeping city. I'm so glad to be just here talking to you. So let's go. Let's talk some Pats.
That's what I'm talking about, man. Hey, we're glad to have you here, brother. It is going to be a great segment, and you certainly, good sir, have one hell of a football team. I know it's been kind of hard, you know, since I've really, really understood and been a huge NFL fan, the Patriots, you know, over the last two decades have been, you know, the top-notch team. They have been the team that everybody's been trying to knock off, the team that you can almost just hand them the damn Lombardi or the Lamar, okay, every year because they are so good. However, in the last couple of years, well, it's been kind of hard. It's been weird seeing this team be mediocre and not the prime rib of the NFL, if you will. But hey, it is what it is, and, you know, Mr. Kraft is over there doing his thing. As long as he got Bill, I still feel like the Pats are the Pats. At the end of the day, it's, I don't know, man, it's been kind of crazy seeing you guys like this, but I still have hope for these Patriots, man, I really do.
You know, as long as you have Bill, there's always a chance. The one thing I must say, once Tom left, it kind of broke that security blanket where Bill could almost do no wrong. Yeah. He now does have a little margin for error. Last season showed that when Bill, the genius that he is, thought he could take a defensive coordinator and just poof, make him an offensive coordinator. That was Matt Patricia. And we all saw how that worked out. Not so well. So we have Bill O'Brien coming in this year. He is an established OC. I have big hopes, big expectations for Mac Jones in his third season, coming off his playoff season his rookie year. He took a step back last year. I have some big hopes coming this year. But, yeah, last year, I just kind of would like to wipe that from my memory. Not a good experience.
Yeah. And you know what? I'm glad they're going a different direction. You know, is what it is. But, you know, you gotta right the ship sometimes. And speaking about that, I know, and you're like, I just want to close the door on the season already. Well, we're going to open up the wounds once again. Sorry about that, Mikey, but really quick, man. 8-9.
As long as it's not the Raiders game. Don't bring that game up.
Well, when you throw the ball directly to Chandler Jones, ex-Patriot, it was the only damn thing he did for my Raiders last year. Sorry, but anyway. Yeah, that loss must have... Anyway, that must have sucked, but...
Not over it yet.
Yeah, not. I feel you. So 8-9 overall, you guys finished under 500. You guys would also finish 3-3 in the AFC East. You start off with a loss in Miami. I don't know what the hell it is about you guys and playing in Miami. You can't seem to get it done over there, but yeah, it's a crazy game. But you guys will lose one in Miami. You defeat Pittsburgh. You drop two straight to two pretty solid teams, Baltimore and Green Bay. And Green Bay in overtime, that was a crazy game. You go two straight over Detroit and Cleveland. You lose a very weird football game to the Chicago Bears. I'm still trying to figure out how you guys lost that game. Then you win three, well, you with the bye included. But within 4 weeks, you win three games. There was a bye week in the middle of all that over the Jets, the Colts, and the Jets again. Look at that. Then you take a dive, fall into Minnesota, you fell to the Bills, defeating the Arizona Cardinals, a extremely hard loss to the Raiders, followed by another very tough loss by the Bengals. Then you defeat Miami at home. Seems to be the thing now. You lose in Miami and you win at home versus Miami. And then you head over to play the Buffalo Bills, have a very, very stout game, but still it just wasn't enough. The guys drop one to them, and it's over. Season is over. If you can just walk us through that thing, man, what was that season like for you last year, Mikey?
Man, what a roller coaster. There were so many games last year where if one thing goes different, one play, one call, just one little bounce goes the other way, we would have been easily 11, 12 wins possibly. That didn't happen. We saw things, crazy things. I mean, you look at the Raiders game last year where it looked like we basically had that game, you know, blocked up to the last second. We had a review go the other way, and then we had that brilliant backwards lateral pass on the very last play of the game to Mac Jones, which we all know what happened. But yeah, it seemed like the Patriots ran into a good number of those games where it was really, there were close games where really one change, one break here or there could have gone the other way. And that's the optimistic view now going into this upcoming season is that hopefully with a competent OC like Bill O'Brien, we'll have that one extra play that will make the difference, that will put us over the top in these close games. We already know Bill Belichick makes up for a lot. His defensive schemes, the way he can confuse, especially young quarterbacks. He's going to give us a win or two along the way as it is, just his great mind. But hopefully we're going to win those 50-50 games that we didn't seem to win any last year. So looking forward to this year. We brought in coming in to the draft, we drafted a defensive stud, Christian Gonzalez, out of Oregon. Some of the reports out of training camp is this dude is a stud. So yeah, moving on to this year from last year, it was the 50-50 games that we seemed to lose all of them last year. Hopefully that's going to change coming up this season.
Well, Mikey, there's reason to believe that, man, because you already kind of, you know, I love it. You already transitioned into the offseason. But yeah, man, Mike Gesicki, longtime Miami Dolphin, man. He is now headed over to the Patriots. He's also an ex-volleyball player. So our boy Taron Rodriguez knows a thing or two about this guy. But beastie tight end. You guys also add one of my guys from my beloved USC Trojans, Juju Smith-Schuster, another extremely solid receiver. I know. It hurts that you didn't get D-Hop. I heard you in Swizzle on Wednesday, this last Wednesday, talking all about how tough, and trust me, My best friend's a Patriots fan. He said the same thing. Like, it sucks. The incentives is what it was really, what he thinks it comes down to is that, you know, D-Hop is kind of like, you know what I can do. Just pay me the guaranteed money. It is what it is, though. I mean, you know, I get it. But regardless, kind of a rough go there, man. You guys could have had D-Hop. Could have, would have, should have, whatever. But regardless, man, you guys got some pretty solid players. Like Cody Davis, Chris Board, you guys stand up him. You guys signed him. You know, a few other big-time pickups here. But go ahead and kind of walk through some of the ones that you feel like Riley Reiff, I feel, is a big-time pickup. Also, Jabril Peppers. But give me your biggest pickups. Also, biggest departures for you for this offseason for the Patriots.
Sure. I would agree with you. I am so excited to see Juju, to see them bring in Juju Smith to the fold, which essentially we traded with the Raiders, or we swapped out our leading receiver from last year, Jacoby Myers. He departs, goes to the Raiders. We bring in Juju. The Patriots, now that we lost out in the D-Hop sweepstakes, they are banking on Juju to have a big, big season. His numbers were decent, not so bad last year with KC. Helped them win the Super Bowl. But they are banking on him to have a big bounce back season. Mike Gesicki is going to be a great addition to the tight end. He's going to tandem with Hunter Henry, who's been fantastic the last couple seasons. He will be replacing Jonnu Smith, who had been one of the biggest high-priced free agent signings for Belichick a couple years ago and was just a total bust. So we shipped him off to Atlanta. We bring in Gesicki, which is going to be big. Our running game is we have our second year back, Ramondre Stevenson. He is an absolute beast. And there's word that Dalvin Cook may be possibly, a potential signee. One really, though, interesting fact that I heard, because you don't really hear too much about the cap and the spending, is that the Patriots actually, and it makes us not getting D-Hop even that much more frustrating, is the Patriots are the 31st team in the league, ranked number 31 in spending. Now you compare this. Now I'll give you some numbers here. The Bills' payroll this coming year is going to be around $306 million. The Pats are at $206. That's $100 million difference. And Bill or whoever is running the show there, we never know because they keep it, under tight. It's like Fort Knox. But and they're gonna tell us that they couldn't sign D-Hop. That to me almost was inexcusable. But to be positive about it, I'm super excited about Juju. Riley Reiff should help shore up the offensive line. We'll see what's going on with some of the guys like Trent Brown, who's been very hit or miss. And there's word that he might not even be reporting to camp. I'm super excited about the stud Christian Gonzalez that we drafted. Back addressing the departures, one that is going to be almost irreplaceable when it comes to experience and skill is Devin McCourty. He retired in the offseason. That's going to be a tough one to replace, but they're going to have kind of a safety by committee, especially in training camp, to see who wins it out. D-Mac is probably, along with Jacoby Myers, our two biggest losses. We also lost running back Harris to Buffalo, which is it's not going to hurt as much because we have Ramondre, but losing D-Mac, he was an extra voice in the locker room, such a smart player. He was almost like having an extra coach on the sidelines. So losing him, I would say, is our biggest departure. And the biggest addition, I would say, would be Juju.
I can definitely agree with that. I did not know that about the cap. I just got to say this right now. Look, there is a fine line between being frugal to save for something good, but when something like D-Hop, seriously, this is no knock to Juju or any of the receivers, because I love Juju, of course, but what I will say about this is, look, man, if you're just holding on to money, okay, that's great, but why are you going to drive a beat-up little nasty car that's definitely run its course and that's on its last leg? You have all the money in the world to buy a brand new, expensive, extremely reliable car, and you still choose, nope, I'm going to keep on driving this. It doesn't make any sense. I'm just saying, you know what I mean? So it just makes me – what you just explained right now, that says so much, because it's like, it is what it is. I get it. The Patriots, they run things the way they run things. But, bro, come on, man.
What do you say for? Come on.
Yeah.
Belichick only got how many years left? Come on. Let's just spend a little.
It's true.
We saw what happened last time we brought in a Hall of Famer receiver with Randy Moss. So, granted, we had Brady, but still. What happened? Exactly. We were just unstoppable. So,
What gets me the most, Mikey, is that, D-Hop, you hear Bill Belichick and all the praise he gives D-Hop. When he's in the other uniform, you know, when they played against him or whatever. You hear him on the sub when they're talking, they're a little mic'd up and everything, how they talk. You just get Bill just praising the hell out of D-Hop. I mean, you know he wanted him. I don't know. It's I don't know. It's weird.
It's baffling. It's totally baffling. He's fawned over D-Hop for years. Like you said, whenever they do those, you know, sound effect shows where you can actually hear, you know, real, like, non-censored Belichick, which he does at the podium, like, when he's actually giving his true feelings. The dude loves D-Hop. we had the money. Like, we're not in cap hell. Like, that's one thing as you know, from the fan standpoint, that's a real head-scratcher. It's, I mean, it's not like they're saving for another free agent that's kind of lingering out there right now. So, yeah, that's one I don't understand. I don't think we ever will. You know, maybe Belichick is just pocketing that money. Maybe he's just buying another boat with it. Who knows? But, I say spend, but, you know, I ain't running that ship. So,
hey, if this is going to be Bill's last go around, man, do it with D-Hop. I don't know how they let that go, but it is what it is. You know, I don't know. I mean, I don't think he's pocketing it, but I don't know where the hell, I don't know what they're saving for, man. But check it out, man. Yeah. Also, I want to ask you guys real quick, too, man. Isaiah Wynn, you guys picked him up a couple years ago. He looked good, promising. Now he's going to the Dolphins. What happened, man?
They drafted him, and he was a stud. Out of college, it looked like we had our, you know, our an offensive lineman for the next, you know, 5 to 10 years. He was fantastic, and then he got injured, and it seemed once he kind of experienced that first injury, he was never the same. He'd come back, he'd get injured, he'd come back, he'd struggle, and it's really unfortunate because he showed some flashes of just being one of those lockdown tackles that just, you know, you're good on that side of the line. Mm-hmm. I think the Pats, after, you know, the last, you know, last couple of years, lost patience. And it's possible, you know, Miami might really get a good one there. If he can get back to his previous form. You know, I hope he does well. I hope he bounces back because the dude has talent. He's got to be healthy.
Agreed. He's a beast, man. And also a pickup that I saw for you guys, Trace McSorley, man. He's been in the league a few years now, you know, previous Penn State guy. He's, maybe 27-ish, 26, 27, I got to say, or somewhere right around there. He's been in the league, you know, here and there. But it's crazy because I can totally see why you guys would pick him up. Mac Jones, we don't even know. Like, we don't. We have no idea. Is he the for real starter? Is he the long-term answer? Is he, I don't know. I don't know. Then you got Bailey Zappe, which is amazing. This dude came out of West Kentucky and just was slinging it all over the place, and then he kind of just fell on his face. So I get it. Trace McSorley is a little bit more veteran. He's also kind of a running type of quarterback. So, I mean, I got to ask you, man, after Tom left, the quarterback carousel has been going around and around and around and around with all these crazy things. What are you looking at this year for the quarterback, man? And I know this is a question I don't usually ask, but since this is a very significant situation, what are you thinking right now with the quarterback situation at the minute?
And with the Pats, you got to ask that. We had 20 years of not, I mean, except for the ACL year, we had 20 years of never having to worry about a quarterback. You see other teams every couple of years, you know, rotating, drafting new guys, having the carousel. I forgot what that was like. It had been so long. That is a completely fair question. And let me say this. Mac Jones was put in almost an impossible situation coming in the man right after Tom Brady. I'll say this too. I've been very impressed with how he's handled himself, you know, even despite last year. His rookie year, he came in. He guided us to the playoffs. Granted, we got blown out in the wild card game. But rookie year, he came in, made the playoffs. Last year, they set him up for failure. He was kind of in a no-win situation, and he struggled. But, you know, that's understandable, second year. It'll be very telling to see what happens this year with Jones having a really good established offensive coordinator, having some more added weapons. Granted, it would have been much better had we had Hopkins, but, you know, we still have added some good weapons. This is going to be a really defining year in his career. because, you know, like you said, they brought in guys like McSorley. We got Zappi. We also, I can't remember the guy's name. We signed an undrafted QB out of Louisville, but he has a very similar skill set to Lamar Jackson. That is one player under the radar we might want to just kind of keep an eye on. He wasn't drafted, but there was a really big bidding war after the draft, in which the Patriots, I think they paid the most that they ever have to an undrafted free agent to him, to get him. I'm trying to remember his name. But he's another player to watch out for. But yes, this is a make or break season for Mac. He's experienced some success. He's dealt with some adversity, and you know, now let's see how he handles that and see if he can bounce back. The QB that I was referring to, the undrafted player, it was from Louisville. His name is Malik Cunningham.
Oh, I remember him. Yes. Okay. I remember yeah. Who you're talking about.
Kind of like a very poor man's Lamar Jackson, from what I've heard.
He's actually pretty solid, man. He's a hell of a player. He just needs tuning.
Yeah. I mean, what better place than you know, having the coaching of New England with Belichick,
yeah,
and Bill O'Brien as well. So, it'll be very interesting. We'll see what happens. Hopefully, they'll have a little bit of a longer leash than they did last year on Mac. I mean, last year too, it was tough for him because he got injured. Bailey Zappi like has had a few breakout games. Mac came back. He struggled like right away. They had a super short leash. They pulled him. That killed his confidence. And it was just kind of just roller coaster the rest of the way. So yeah, it'll be very interesting to see Mac and company, what goes on. Hopefully he can right the ship and do things, you know, and get back to the playoffs, because it feels like it's been a while.
No, it has been. And talking real quick about the draft, I know you already briefly touched on him, but Chris Gonzalez, just what a great pick there out of Oregon. I'm a Pac-12 guy, so I've been able to see him time and time again at Oregon, and the guy is as advertised. Kenyon White, Keon White, defensive end out of Georgia Tech, an absolute stud in the second round there. Marne Mapu, this dude is, I love him. He's from Sacramento State. He's a FCS guy, not an FBS guy. I think he can transition well into the NFL. Jake Andrews, center out of Troy. I mean, you guys had some pretty solid picks, all right? So I got to know, man, what are your thoughts on these guys? Who do you think could be a instant presence? Who may need a little work? I mean, overall, what do you think about the draft this year for your Pats?
Absolutely stunned Gonzalez was available at 17. Best cornerback in the draft, in my opinion. You don't get a lot of cornerbacks with his height. I think he's 6'3". His speed, his length, the athleticism. Usually when players have those attributes, they're wide receivers. So absolutely thrilled to get him at 17. Never thought he'd be there. Keon White, also a steal. It's funny, if you watch, if you YouTube his reaction during the draft, he was so pissed that he went, you know, as far down that he did. He didn't even crack a smile when he was drafted. So this dude has a chip on his shoulder, and he's out to prove the critics or prove every team that passed on him wrong. A very cool tidbit of info about Marne Mapu, the FCS standout from Sacramento State. Actually, if you check the R Bleepin' City Twitter page, I recently spoke with Matthew Slater, SoCal guy, great player from one of our probably our best special team player ever. Here's a really cool tidbit of info. So when Matthew Slater first came to the Patriots, he played his rookie year with Junior Seau. Junior Seau also played against Matthew's dad, Jackie Slater, when Jackie was in the Rams.
That's awesome.
Now with Marne Mapu, He is the nephew of Junior Seau.
No.
Later, World Cup played with Junior Seau's nephew, Junior Seau, and who had played against his dad. So it's just a crazy connection there.
That's so cool.
Through the three generations with Slater.
That's so cool. Yeah, man. Slater. For those of you who don't know, of course, Matthew Slater, product of Southern California, played for the Servite High School. As you guys know, Southern California is home to some of the nation's best football programs, including Mater Dei, St. John Bosco, of course, Servite, these monstrous schools, Corona Centennial, which I don't live too far away from. Yeah, just big-time monstrous programs. And, well, Matthew Slater was a part of that. he played for the Friars, and yeah, that's a really cool deal, man. Big ups to Matthew Slater, of course, as well. He's awesome. And that's so cool, man. I love the video you got, by the way, with him, man. That was really, really neat. So with that said, man, really quick.
Appreciate it.
Absolutely, brother. So let's go ahead and roll on into this season. Look, the Patriots, they have their work cut out for them, all right? We know that. You know it. I know it. We all know it, all right? So it's going to be a season. Now, what kind of season? That's up to them. But, man, you guys start things off with the freaking Eagles. Of all teams, you guys start off with probably the best pound-for-pound team in the NFL, who has, you know, pretty much the entire roster of Georgia. Okay, this team is extremely talented. That defensive line is probably one of the best defensive lines ever assembled. I mean, this is going to be a very good team. So you guys start off with that team. Then, you know, you guys continue on. It looks like you guys are playing, if I'm not mistaken, the AFC West. That shouldn't be very hard. But you guys are playing the AFC West. I mean, I'm not trying to. I mean, besides the Chiefs.
Never know these days. I mean, last year.
Besides the Chiefs, I'm just saying. Well, true, but good stuff there. And of course, continuing on with the rest of the with the Eagles, of course, the NFC East looks like you're playing as well this year with a couple outlier teams in there as well. All right, talk to us, man, Mikey. How you feeling about this year? What are your expectations?
Let me say, the AFC East is just going to be a gauntlet. That's going to be brutal. I came to expect two automatic wins every year with the Jets. Can't say that this year. Rodgers is going to be in town there. It's going to be very interesting to see how that goes. Who knows? He may get injured in training camp. They've already said he's had a few calf issues. But this year, a lot of things need to go right. The schedule makers did not do them any favors. They have one of the toughest schedules in the league, especially opening it up with Philly. I mean, Philly's got a chip on their shoulder. They want to come out like you know, gang beaters and really just kind of prove to the league that they, you know, last year was not a fluke. So we're right away, we're kind of up against it. That being said, a lot of things do have to go right for the Pats, but I am optimistic. I think if they can get – Pats have a fantastic defense. They were one of the best defenses in the league last year. Their defense for some games last year was almost better than their offense. So I'm not worried about the defense. A lot of things have to go right this year for the offense, but if they do, and things you know, if we can manage to maybe beat Miami in Miami this year, or have some of the 50-50 wins that we did not have last year, if things go right, I can absolutely see this team winning 10, 11 games, making the playoffs. How far they can go, that's another deal. But it's the NFL. Injuries, crazy things can happen. So the schedule is going to be brutal. It's going to be The AFC East is going to just be a dogfight. This season could go anywhere from you know, an 8-win season to, you know, I'd say worst case scenario, 7-8 wins to, you know, best case scenario. If everything breaks correctly, they could have 11-12 wins and be right back in the playoffs. So it's going to be tough. But They have the tool. They have the tools. They have the coaching. So, you know, let's get it on. Let's see what happens.
I love it, man. I love the attitude. I love you. You have this great. It's not easy for a Patriots fan right now after seeing the success you have seen. But I'll tell you what, man, you have the right attitude. That's a great way of looking at it. All right, brother. Well, we have reached the final segment of this show. Well, of this segment, that is. The final segment of the Patriots segment. And, well, you're starting things off, man. After this, we are talking Miami Dolphins. We are talking New York Jets. And we're talking about those Buffalo Bills. It's a tough division this year, man. You're right. Rodgers, who knows? How's that going to work? How's he going to look? What are they going to do? The Dolphins are so hit or miss. And the Bills, they're the Bills, man. So it's going to be a tough division. On top of that, the AFC West, the NFC East. It's going to be a – this is another true test for this team. But without further ado, this is a little segment I like to call Stick It to 'Em, man. And what is this segment all about, Mikey? Well, very easy, man. You tell me how you think the other three teams in your division are going to do, the teams that you love to hate, the teams that love to hate you back. And on top of that, this is always a fun one because you can be nice and respectful. You can be mean and ugly. Whatever you want to say about those three teams and how you think they're going to do this season, it's all on you. All thoughts, comments, and whatever it is, depending on whatever he says, of course, is their own thoughts. Like Mikey's here, and well, let's have some fun. Mikey Two Guns, stick it to him.
All right, in my crystal ball, perfect world, here's what's going to happen. The Bills, great team, super talented. We'll look at their history. They choke. They're chokers. You saw some turmoil last year. It's amazing. Stephon Diggs, one of the most talented receivers in the league with one of the best quarterbacks, Josh Allen. They had great, put up great numbers. They're not getting along. So perfect scenario. They have a whole blow up. There's chaos in their locker room. They struggle. Have a mediocre year. Let's go to Miami. Well, you know, it's a coin flip. One week they're great. One week they stink. You know what? Their quarterback Tua, super talented. Can't stay on the field. I don't wish injury on any player, but he's almost guaranteed to miss, you know, a good handful of games next year. Hopefully when he does, Pats take advantage. They lose all the games that he misses or when the Pats play him. And then we come to the Jets. The Jets. The two guaranteed wins every year. Yes, they're not going to be two easy cakewalks this year. But I don't see Rodgers, number one, staying healthy. Number two, getting along with his teammates that well, because he always seems to rub people the wrong way. So I see there being turmoil there as well. With all this chaos going on in the division, that leaves the most well-coached, well-disciplined, smartest, just best put together team like the Patriots, taking advantage of all that turmoil, all that chaos there, and boom. Taking the East this year. That's how I see it, my friend.
I will tell you right now, brother, that was absolutely awesome. Can we get an applause for Mikey? That was awesome, brother. That was absolutely awesome. I love it. I love it. You are a true diehard Pat through and through, man. And it is always. It is just a blast. It was so great having you on today's show, man. And thanks again for sparing the time here. This has been so much fun. And you set the tone, man. I'm telling you, next up we're talking Dolphins. After that, it's Jets. And then to finish off the day today, day number two of AFC week, once again, AFC East Day. We're finishing off with the Bills. And you definitely set the tone, brother. So thanks again for being here today. Thank you so much for being a part of the iSports Radio team, man. And we are so excited to air this thing. And we know that your Patriots got some work to do. But you know what, man? Let's see if they put in that work this year. Let's see if they make it happen, yeah? Let's do it.
Absolutely. And Larry, always a pleasure to come on your show. It's been an honor. Hopefully I can get you on my show very soon.
I'm excited.
And lastly, I hope we're back here I hope we can reconnect in December. Looking back on the show, and Larry, you'll be like, look at you. Look, you predicted all this right. You called it my. You guys are in the playoffs. You guys are going to the championship. I hope we can come back to that in December.
I love it, brother. Well, hey, great stuff there, man. Let all these our Patriots fans know, man. Where can they find you? Where can they find your show? Where can they find your social media? Where can they find you at, man?
Absolutely, man. Check out the Twitter page, Our Bleepin' City, i.e. it is spelt O-U-R-B-L. what did I forget? I forgot how to spell now. It's O-U-R-B-L-E-E-P-N-C-I-T-Y-I-E. Twitter. If you want to check me out on Instagram, the Our Bleepin' City page is Mikey2, G-U-N-Z-Z, Our Bleepin' City. Check, obviously, Spotify, Apple, Spreaker, all the platforms. You download the show if you can't catch it live. Wednesdays, 7 to 8, we're going to be bringing the heat. We're going to be bringing, you know, by the way, while I snack on some of that amazing Planet Jerky.
Yeah!
But we'll be bringing the heat every Wednesday, 7 to 8. I will see you, Larry, there. I will see all the Boston fans, all the haters. Please, come on in.
I love it. Hey, man, you and Swizzle do a great job, man. I'm loving it. Our Bleepin' City here on IE Sports Radio, man. Every single Wednesday, 8 p.m. Pacific time. Well, sorry, no, 7 p.m. Eastern. Ooh, I guess that was a brain fart. 7 p.m. Eastern time, 4 p.m. Pacific time, y'all. Show some love. Always a great show. Big ups, man. Wishing y'all the best day, man. You and Swizzle have a great day. Thank you so much for being here today, man. And we look forward to having you back very soon, brother. With that said, take care, and we will be having you back on the show as soon as we can.
Always a pleasure, Larry. Thank you, my friend.
Always, brother. Take care.
All right, you too, man.
All right, you guys. That was, of course, our boy Mikey C, man. Mikey Two Guns. Great dude. And, well, that is going to do it for this segment. When we come back, oh, it's about that time. We're about to jump on in to a complete rival of, well, they're all rivals, right? But the Patriots can't seem to beat these guys on the road. Well, let's see. Will it happen this year, or will that tradition continue? Will the Finns be able to knock off those Patriots in Foxborough? Oh, we got some good stuff coming up, y'all. We are just one team down and three to go here on day number two of AFC week, AFC East Day. One team down, three to go. We're talking Miami Dolphins when we come back. Once again, listening to Three and Out, Eight Divisions in 8 Days, right here on IE Sports Radio. Your direct feed for all that is sports. We'll be right back talking Dolphins after this.
All right, all right, all right. Welcome to AZ Sports Daily. I'm your host, Kiernan Daly, bringing the heat to Arizona sports. There's no discrimination here. We're going to talk about every sports team, professional and college. The show is all about you, the listener. I'm here to entertain you. Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here? It's going to be fun, high energy. You may not agree with what I say. That's okay. Let me hear you. Let's talk about it. Join me every Wednesday, 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, right here on AZ Sports Daily. That's AZ Sports, D-A-L-E-Y, and at IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
What's up, sports fans? You're listening to IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. I'm your favorite West Coast Wisconsinite, Bernie Bango. And if you're a cheesehead, come listen to my show, Big Cheese Sports, where we road trip around America's Dairyland, previewing, reviewing, predicting, debating, and digging into all that is Wisconsin sports at the college and pro levels. Join me on IE Sports Radio, Sundays at 1 p.m. Central Standard. Bernie out.
What up, Boston sports fans? This is Mikey Two Guns here, your host of Our Bleepin' City, airing every Wednesday night from 7 to 8 p.m. right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. Please join me. We'll talk everything Boston sports, all the local teams, college teams. I'm even down to talk MMA, boxing, whatever you guys want. So join me every Wednesday night, 7 to 8 p.m. Chime in with your questions on the chat, tweet the show. We'll even have call-ins. I can't wait to hear from you guys. This is going to be a lot of fun. So once again, it's Our Bleepin' City. I am your host, Mikey Two Guns, every Wednesday night from 7 to 8 p.m. right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. See you soon, people.
Welcome back, football fans. Well, here we are, day number two of AFC week here on 3 and Out, 8 divisions in 8 days. Man, AFC West was a lot of fun yesterday, and today, here we are, AFC East. We just finished up with our boy Mikey Two Guns talking about the Patriots. He was the leadoff man tonight, talking about his Pats, and well, here we are with our second guest of the evening, well, of the afternoon, whichever you want to call it, wherever you're listening from, but really cool, actually. He is our first non-IE Sports Radio host. Yesterday, we had Aaron, Kale, Taryn, and Bishop, all of those guys host shows here on IE Sports Radio. The guy you just heard right now, Mikey Two Guns, he is the host of our Boston show, Our Bleepin' City here on IE Sports Radio. Catch him on Wednesday evenings at 4 p.m. for me, but 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific time. And well, this is our first non-host from the network, and I'm glad to have him here, y'all. He is a real chill, laid-back dude. He has his own YouTube channel. He jumps up on there when he can, but at the end of the day, his fandom says it all, and I'm so glad we can have him on here today. Here to help me talk about these Miami Dolphins, man, all the way down that 305. These dudes right here have quite the team, and well, it's all about if they can just get it together, and when they do that, this team has a lot of promise. Will it be this season? We shall see, but here to help me talk about those Miami Dolphins, ladies and gentlemen, he is, of course, the creator of DC Kai 305 on YouTube, and well, that's what they call him. Ladies and gentlemen, welcoming, of course, the one, the only, Mr. DC Kai. What's going on, brother? How you doing tonight, man?
What's up? I'm doing great. Thanks for having me, man. Great introduction, man. I feel like a celebrity. Let's go, man.
Hey, brother, you a celebrity here? That's what I want. That's what I want to hear. You're a celebrity here, man. That's who we are. IE Sports Radio, by the fans, for the fans, and that's how we treat our guests, brother. So I'm glad you're here tonight. You know, hey, you just being here alone, just it makes the show that much better. And hey, just thanks again for being on the show tonight.
Hey, I appreciate you reaching out to me, man. Anytime, you know, I love talking Dolphins. You know, I love talking sports.
Hey, brother, that's gonna be. That's what it's all about, and this is going to be a fun interview, man. So we're glad to have you here. Let's get on into it, man. So these Miami Dolphins. All right. So I know you're probably like, I don't want to talk about this. And you know what? I don't blame you. It's okay, because I'm a Raider fan. I don't want to talk about last season or the season before that or really any season before 2002. So I'm just saying. But with that said, man, I mean, we had a few in there. But you guys, man. 9-9 overall. You finished the AFC East. You finished at 3-4. And let's just go ahead and recap this season, man. Or last season. Last year, I don't know what it is, but the Patriots, they can't make it happen versus you guys at home. You guys seem to own them there, and it's been happening the last couple of years. And hey, good for you guys, man. Y'all took them out in game number one, week number one. Then in week number two, hey, Baltimore, boom, guess what? We take y'all too. Then what was even more impressive was the Buffalo Bills. a very strong team. This team, I mean, they had last year, they were some people's Super Bowl pick, man. But what happened? Mm-hmm. Y'all took them out in week number three. Then it just kind of got weird. I know there was a lot of things happening last year. Tua, other injuries. I get it. I understand that. But, man, from a 3-0 start to a three-game skid, you would drop one to the Cincinnati Bengals, the New York Jets, and another one to Minnesota. Then this is the craziest thing. You talk about a roller coaster, brother. I mean, this – the way the season looks, it looks like a dolphin going under the water and swimming up and popping up and going back down. I mean, seriously, because then y'all get not one, not two, not three, not four, but five straight, man. Y'all took out the Steelers, Lions, Bears, the Browns. You had a bye week, and you came back, and you took out the Houston Texans, and then here we go again. You just win five games straight, and what happens? You lose five games straight, starting with the Niners, Chargers, the Bills came back for y'all, the Packers. You went up to Foxborough, dropped that game in New England, and then in a very odd, low-scoring, fun defensive game, though, you guys would take out the Jets in the last week of the season. You would head on over to Buffalo in the wild card. And I'll tell you right now, man, these Dolphins played as – I don't know if they could have played any better that day, man. But It was a very good fight, very good game. Unfortunately, though, wasn't your guys' day. You would drop it 34-31 to Buffalo, and that would end off the season for you guys. So I'm going to go ahead and shut up. But hey, man, DC Kai, talk to us, man. Give us every raw emotion from last year.
It was just tough watching the Dolphins last year, but in a good way. Like we bust out on the scene with a nice victory against the Patriots. I had me cheering. I thought we was going to run it up real. Like when you actually watched in that game, like we were all firing all pistons at the beginning of the game, and then things just got tight. And just like you said, it's like I can't remember the Patriots beating us at home in like several years. All the way just thinking about the miracle in Miami when we knocked Tom Brady, gave him his last loss as a Patriot. Well, you know, regular season.
That's right.
It's just crazy. And then second game of the year, roaring back. I mean, that's when everybody was like, we got our guy. Like that, he started off the game with I think two picks. And the defense was just like, I don't know how to explain it. They were just standing around. Like that defense that our coordinator, I don't even want to speak his name, was running. It was just like, you can tell that, you know, X was hurt and you still got him on an island. Then that week three against Buffalo. Oh my God. I just knew that we were going to the Super Bowl.
Right?
Just like you say, that was the consensus. It was Buffalo year. Like all offseason, all us, I was hearing was, hey, this is the Buffalo's year. They are going to destroy the Dolphins when they play in week three. And when we played them, it was apparent that we had caught up. But also in that game, no shade at Matt Milano, but it was a little bit dirty to me. That push that sent Tua to concussion protocol, which they said it was a back, but hey, if you watch the game, you can see it was something, you know, functionally not working correctly. We still was able to eke out a victory, but then you have Bengals. You know, we all know the fencing pose, and you know that was tough to watch. Being a big supporter of Tua Tagovailoa, one of those things that I just like to say, I watch every throw the kid made at Alabama, not because I was a Tua fan, just because I hate Nick Saban. I was hoping Alabama lose, but in the process, I'm watching Jalen Hurts, Mac Jones.
That was funny.
I'm just being honest, you know, in the process, you know, because I just hate Nick Saban, how he left us back in 2006, you know. He left in the darkness of night, as I like to say, you know. I was like 16 at the time or something.
Like when the Baltimore Colts, man.
100%. So, there, you know, it just injuries, you know, just injuries to not being able to stay healthy. Just, you know, I think it just killed our season a little bit, and it was a roller coaster. Like you said, we win three straight, we lose three straight. We win four straight, we lose four straight. Five straight, and then we lose five straight. It was just an up and, like I said, it was obviously an up and down roller coaster of a season.
It was, man. It, I guess that's pretty funny. But no, it's true, man. You guys had Saban back then. Yeah, we're almost the same age then, man. So yeah, I was in high school around there too. So it's crazy to think, man. Now look at him. I mean, he's doing his thing over in Bama, cool. But yeah, man, what did you know? You guys get, you know, a product of his teaching, you know, of his coaching at quarterback. And he's pretty solid. But, you know, it's true. You guys had a year, man. The year was just so weird, but you happened to get to the playoffs. You did it. And, you know, unfortunately, it was one and done, but that's a lot better than a lot of other teams out there, man. I'll tell you that. So good year for the most part, but I know you guys are hungry for more. And let's go ahead and transition now into this season, man. We had a pretty solid offseason. Let's talk about some of your guys' key pickups, some of your key departures. I know Jalen Ramsey, of course. I mean, that's kind of the elephant in the room right now coming on over in a trade from the Rams. We also would have, let me see, Chosen Anderson is coming back, is coming on over as well. A tough one, at least for me, I would say. I mean, Mike Gesicki, a former volleyball player, you know what I mean? He's heading over to the Patriots to a tough go, a tough place. Braxton Berrios, though, another dude from the division that's heading on over to the Dolphins from the Jets. You guys, Eric Rowe would head on over to the Panthers. I mean, just so many pieces. This guy's going here, this guy's going here, this guy's coming here. I mean, you guys had a very eventful offseason, in my opinion, in free agency. And, well, I'm not going to hog it all, though, man. You go ahead, man. Let us know. Give us your biggest pickups and your biggest departures for the Dolphins, and then we're going to go ahead and jump on to the draft.
100%. Jalen Ramsey, like, who could you say more than Jalen Ramsey? Like, like you said, but outside of Jalen Ramsey, I think Chosen and Berrios. So now that we have, if Berrios makes this team, we have a legit special teams guy that can return kicks, that we're not putting Jalen Waddle, Tyreek Hill, or Javon Holland at risk. It's exciting to have, you know, he'll go back there when we're in a tough spot. But like every time Javon Holland was back there, knowing that he was our, you know, starting free safety or safety, because, you know, he does certain stuff, you know, he moves around the field. It made me queasy. It just made me queasy. But yeah, so the re-signing of Raheem Mostert, I think that does dividends for us, and also of Jeff Wilson. I like when he came in the second half of the season. I love what he, you know, the production that he was giving us. I don't know, as far as big losses, Eric Rowe, he was okay. Like, he was okay for the team, you know, doing his job and whatnot, but he seemed to get beat in coverage a lot. But, you know, he had that game against, was it Mark Andrews? Or I forgot where he just, you know, he put some clamps on him. But outside of that, I would say Byron Jones, but he didn't do anything for us last year. Like, if he was a 2021 Byron Jones that, you know, was opposite of X, that, you know, yeah, but like Byron Jones, you know, off of that Achilles injury, I just don't see, like, that would be my biggest loss. Mike Gesicki, I'm a big Mikey G fan. I wanted him to work in this offense, but it just didn't occur. It sucks, but they're moving forward with Durham Smite. What's that guy's name from Broncos? Eric Serbert, or I forgot how you say his name.
Yeah, he
I
has apologize. A name.
yeah, and then we drafted the kid. Oh, well, we'll get to that. but yeah, so I the biggest Jalen Ramsey. The biggest gang, Jalen Ramsey, the biggest loss, I would say Byron Jones, because that's the only other. We really didn't lose anybody. Melvin Ingram. I was just looking at something about Melvin Gordon. That's why he was on my mind. But Melvin Ingram, I think that was a big loss as far as I think he really helped JP, Jalen Phillips, last year as a mentor. Just, you know, he talked about hand placement, all these things that Melvin Ingram was teaching him. So I would say Melvin Ingram. I'm going with Melvin Ingram. Biggest loss.
I can see that too, man. Really, really big loss there. But man, I'll tell you, that Jalen Ramsey pickup, oh, that is nice. I mean, the dude plays so damn well. This is exciting for the Dolphins for sure right now. So you got a big-time corner coming in. And, yeah, let's just get on into that draft, man. I mean, you know, no first round this year, but – dude, Cam Smith is pretty dang good, man. I like him. I really do think he's a solid player. He's got a lot to offer a team. The Gamecocks were very underrated. I think this guy is going to be a very, very, very nice piece in that defense soon. But, you know, you picked him up second round. Third round, Devin Akane. It's crazy. I don't ever know if I'm pronouncing it correctly, but running back out of Texas A&M. This guy is solid. I love that. You know, and it's crazy, man. I've seen videos all over YouTube recently in the last, like, 2 or 3 days. Our chief editor of our blog, Mike Pat, big shout out to him. He hosts our DMV show. Everybody out there listening, of course, with a little bit of wine as well. Let's whine about DMV sports. So big ups to him. But he just wrote a really cool blog about running backs and, like, their value. And it's crazy because, like, it's true. Like, I seen a video the other day on YouTube talking about, is the running back position dying? So, I mean, you know, is it that Belichickian type of deal where we just don't value the running backs? We get 3 or 4 of them. We just run them all differently and, like, whenever, however, switch them in, switch them out. So, I don't know. I mean, is this going to – is Devin going to jump up in here and be a part of that? Is he going to be a bigger piece? I mean, you know, how is it going to work with him? But I still think no matter how they use him, he's a special talent. So, I mean, you know, then you got some later round guys, but, you know, just talking about those first two and everything, you only had a couple picks, but overall, man, go ahead and talk about these real quick. Let us know how you think about this draft, how you think you guys did, and what do you think these guys are going to, you know, attribute to the team?
Yeah. So Cam Smith, I loved him coming out of South Carolina, the Gamecocks. He was on the team with what's the guy that got drafted by the Panthers? Can't think. He was on the team, but he was redshirting at the time. So I've been following Cam Smith for a little bit. South Carolina kid. I've been following him for a little bit. So when we drafted him, I was overhyped. If you go check my Twitter feed, I was, you know, going crazy because, you know, I really like the kid. I think he's going to do well, and it shows me that the writing is kind of on the wall for Noah Igbinoghene. It's just like, and Noah is almost the same age as this kid. I think he's a couple months older than Cam. That's the crazy thing. And he's been in the league almost 4 years. I know I'm going off topic, but just thinking about that, you know, off the top of my head. But yeah, so Cam Smith, very physical corner. He reminded me when I put this on my Twitter as well. He reminded me of Rashad Mathis, if you remember that guy from Jacksonville. That was my comp for him. Not overly athletic, but athletic enough. So when I looked at him, I was like, ooh, I like what I see. I like what I see. So he has a chance to learn behind two all-pro corners. Like that's a good spot for him. And he can be the third, fourth, fifth, or he can even, like, redshirt. You never know. But I think our detriment last year was the lack of depth at cornerback. When Byron Jones was down, we had, you know, Nick Needham. Then Nick Needham goes down. Then we had Noah. And then we had some Jethan Bethu and what's the other guy's name? I can't think of his name off, but he's no longer on the team. So we didn't have great depth. So I believe Cam Smith, even if he doesn't come in and play off rip, if, you know, X get Nick, you know, because X had growing issue last year. So hopefully, you know, if push comes to shove, we got Cam and then Devin, I think it's pronounced A-Chain. Because I got A-Chain. I have heard a whole bunch of different pronunciations. So hopefully, you know, once they do that on their website, when they say how to pronounce their names, I'll get it down packed. But just looking at his highlights, amazing. He has, like, that. My comp for him was CJ2K, Chris Johnson. That was my comp for Devon A-Chain coming out. They play around the same. I think Devon was, like, a couple pounds lighter, and he when he showed up to camp, rookie camp, he was only 1 pound lighter than what Chris Johnson played. So my comparison with his contact balance, if you watch his highlights, he bounces off a lot of tackles. So I believe that they're going to do the rotation. He's not going to be a feature back. I think they're going to go with the rotation with he's going to be explosive. They're going to probably use him in, you know, third downs and stuff like that, or, you know, stretch plays and stuff like that, because he bounces outside and he's gone. But he also picks the hole, like, just like I say, Chris Jones, he picks the hole pretty good, and he keeps it moving. He breaks tackles for a smaller back. He breaks a lot of tackles. If, you know, you just go back and look at how many tackles he's broke at Texas A&M. And I talk about Elijah Higgins a little bit because that's another guy that I kind of like our sixth round pick. I think Mike McDaniels has his type tight end that he wants to breed or to grow, because even with our the tight end that we had last year, I'm not naming Durham Smythe or the guy that we had got from the Steelers. I can't think of his name. He's off the team too. But he likes the hybrid. You know, he wants that move tight end, but a little bit more wiggle than Gesicki. And I think Higgins can provide that for the Dolphins.
Wow. Let me hit that applause button. But yes. See, this is why we're by the fans for the fans, man. Because we have cats like you who come up on here and just pour it all out. And see, that is great content. So, great stuff, man. Great job there, brother. So I'll tell you right now. This team has so much promise. I mean, there's so much there right now. You look at that depth chart. It's there, and I couldn't agree more. I'm over here shaking my head up and down, man, right now. I look like a Pez dispenser when you're over here saying about the corner, because it's true. You guys last year had a corner problem. Like, oh, my gosh. Every time you turn around, it's like no one was healthy in that secondary. And I mean, come on. What are you going to do if you're facing the Dolphins? Just throw on them. You know what I mean? Like, it's there. Why not? So this year, I feel like you guys addressed that, and this is just – it's the beginning to a beautiful thing if you guys can continue on this road, man, because it's pretty solid so far what you guys got. So moving into this season. Okay, so if I'm not mistaken, let's take a look at who everybody's got. So you guys got, looks like it's going to be the – oh, that's going to be fun. The AFC West I see is in there. And who else? The NFC East. Looks like the NFC East. Okay, so NFC East, AFC West. Okay, so we're talking about, you know, a Cowboys team who – They're coming, but are they going to be, you know, they're going to be a pretty tough team, but will they be that big, scary giant? You know, I mean, we'll see. The Giants, they got all kinds of problems, including Saquon Barkley probably, you know, sitting out at the moment. I mean, that's, but who knows, you know, they surprised people last year, but okay. So let's be real. The Eagles have probably the scariest defensive line to ever have been put together in the history of football. I'm just going to be real.
That's, I mean, facts.
They have the whole dang Georgia roster on their team, basically. So, I mean, the Eagles look extremely scary. So there's that. Nothing more I can say. The Commanders, they always have a really nice D-line. But, you know, what are they going to look like this year? Then in the West, man, the Raiders, that shouldn't be very hard. I'm just saying, you know, they're falling apart at the seams over there. Denver, you know, they're coming. Sean Payton, they got a thing going over there now. I think it'll be about a year for them to gel, maybe a little longer. But, you know, it's coming. The Chargers, last year, man, I had that team going to the Super Bowl. And I'm a Raider fan. And I was just being real because I think this team was really that good. Unfortunately, they got bit by the injury bug and they just destroyed their season. And then, of course, you know, no pressure, but you guys got the defending Super Bowl champion Chiefs up on the schedule. So I'm just saying, man, it's a lot. You guys got you know, there's a couple outlier teams on there as well. I see Baltimore and everything. But I'll tell you, man, this is a really fun schedule. Give me a realistic view, man. What do you really think your Dolphins can do this year?
So my best case scenario is 14-3. That was my best case scenario with losses to possibly Kansas City, Philadelphia, and Baltimore. Buffalo. I think I doubt we sweep the Buffalo Bills this year. I hate to say it because all the analysts are saying it, but it's true. It's also true. That's dealing with Tua health. Tua health is a big thing because he's on all cylinders, our offense looks almost unstoppable. But benchmarks at Kansas City, week 9. I don't see that. I'm NFC least outside of Philadelphia. That's just how I feel. I don't fear any team. Like, Cowboys have been running amok on that division, and you had the Commanders and the Giants in that division just stinking it up. Daboll has done a good job with, you know, masking Daniel Jones' ability, but deficiencies. But worst case scenario, I'm thinking 10-7 wild card. But I honestly believe we can be the number one seed in the AFC. I know that sound crazy, but people said that Tua couldn't throw the deep ball, even though I knew that, you know, that was lies. But and he led the league in deep ball percentage and was the best deep ball passer. I honestly believe that we can be, you know, a great team. Just what's your boy last, the clip that you sent me, he believes that Kansas City kind of going to have a down year, but then he gave a good, he was like, I think you said 14-3 or so it's out there. It's out there. It may be our time, you know, it may be our time, but I think 14-3 is a reasonable, with Vic Fangio. I forgot even mentioning the addition of Vic Fangio. That's probably one of the biggest of Jalen Ramsey. That's probably one of the biggest off-season gets of the year. In all the football, Vic Fangio coming, Big Vic energy, as they like to say nowadays, Big Vic energy. I just believe worst case scenario, 10-7, sneak into the playoffs, or a number one seed at 14-3.
You know what, man? That's saying a lot. That's saying a lot. And this team, but here's the thing, though. You really believe in this team, number one. Number two thing, you see something special that a lot of people may not see, man. And that's to me, that's a stretch, but I think that's awesome, because if you look at this, if you look at this roster and you look at this team, what they've done, you look at the schedule, I mean, it's there. You know what I mean? Like, any given day, man, that it can happen. So this team has so much talent on it. So I could totally see it, man. I mean, this is a team last year that if a few more plays would have gone the other way, man, we're looking at a team with a very good record and a much higher seed, you know?
And I just want to say, this is Tua's first year outside of high school, not just, you know, the NFL. This is his first year coming back to back years with the same offense. So this is his, like, literally, this is since high school. This is his first year coming back-to-back years with the same offensive coordinator, with the same offense since he was in high school.
That's incredible. I didn't even know that. That's crazy. So, I mean, yeah, so look at that. You know, what – my gosh, you give somebody like that some stability like that. I mean, it's just – it could say so much. It does so much. And this guy is a stud, man. So I'm excited. I really am to see this team get out there on that field and play, man. And this is it's a team that is definitely on a mission. They're going and getting what they need. I love the draft. They drafted what they needed with the picks that they had. I mean, you know, go and get Jalen Ramsey, Fangio. I mean, this is just, it's a lot, man. And there's a lot to be excited about right now if you're a Dolphins fan. So with that said, brother, you know, and it's funny, I know you were just listening to that last segment right now with Bishop talking about, you know, it might be a little down year for the Chiefs. So, yeah, you're right, man. I mean, hey, you're right. So with that said, man, you just heard his ending, and well, you're about to do the same exact thing, man. This little segment here at the end is so much fun. A little stick it to him segment here where, you know, you get to tell me a little bit about what you think the other three teams are going to do this year, the teams that you love to hate, and well, the teams that just can't stand your team right back. It's fun. It's a rivalry. It's football. That's what it's all about. And, you know, tons of respect in there, but at the same exact time, got to have that bitter rivalry, and there it is, man. So go ahead, man. Let everybody know what you think those other three teams are going to do this year. And, hey, it's okay to sprinkle a little bit on top and let us know how you really feel about those teams. So without further ado, DC Kai, stick it to them.
So I'm going to start off with the New York Jets. Like, yeah, just the nasty New York Jets. That's what I like to call them. Honestly, they've been a bottom dweller in our division for the last – what, 10 years? They probably have like one winning season since then. They're going to be at the bottom, outside of, if not the Patriots, but Patriots do Patriots things, and I believe that they get the third spot in the division. Patriots, I have a lot of respect for them, but just a lot of hate. Like, Bill Belichick is a cheat. Bill Belichick, that's his name, Bill Belichick. But, you know, you got to respect what they did, you know, the last couple of years. But I believe Mac Jones is a fraud. He was exposed last year when they didn't have any offensive coordinator. Like Josh McDaniels was, you know, saved that guy. But they're going to be trash, too. So they're going to be bottom with the Jets. Buffalo Bills, their window closed. I heard your boy last. It's not closing. It's closed. You got stuff going on with Stephon Diggs and Josh Allen. I just think the Jills are not going to make it this year. They're going to be exposed. We're going to run rampant on them. They're going to get one on us by like 3 points, but we're going to blow them out when we go against them at home or away, whatever you want to call it. But I believe the Buffalo Bills probably going to be like maybe 10-7, maybe make the playoffs, but it's not going to be good for the Buffalo Bills fans. They're just going to be subpar. Josh Allen is going to get exposed. Aaron Rodgers, like, I got to go back to the Jets. Aaron Rodgers, this washed up old geezer. it's over for him. It's over for him.
Man, you got me rolling over here. I'm over here hitting all the sound effects for you. I got the bell ringing, the lightning going off right now. Man, hit the applause button, though, right now, man, because that was crazy. Yeah, and of course, silly me, how could I forget about, throwing in the AFC East in there, but yeah, man, I mean, hey, Rodgers, is this team going to be what everybody thinks it is? Are the Bills going to be as strong as they were last year? There's reason to believe that this team is going to be extremely strong. I mean, I really think that they can still be a big time threat. But it's true. I mean, I feel like this team right now could go to the bowl. But at the same exact time, if issues bring them down, we don't know what's going to happen from one week from the next. I mean, look at last year. I'm over here picking the Chargers, and I didn't see that. So, I mean, it can happen. But you guys, man, are a special team. There's a lot going on with the Dolphins. You guys are so worthy to have on the radar, man, and just great overall stuff, man. So, once again, y'all, DC Kai, man. Dude, that was awesome, man. Thank you so much for joining me tonight, brother. So, last but not least, please plug everything, man. Your Twitter, wherever you want. Well, I guess X now, whatever the hell it's called. But, you of course, let everybody know, man, where they can find you, your YouTube channel, when you do it, how you do it, whichever you want to do, man. Let everybody know. Let all these Dolphins fans, man, hashtag fins up. Let them know where they can find you, man.
Hey, you can find me on YouTube, DC_Kai305. We're going to be repping it back up starting next week. Preseason, we're going to start repping it up. You can find me on Twitter, DC Kai Kid 305, DC_Kai305. My YouTube, if I didn't say it. I interact with everybody. I like to give banter back and forth, never personal, always sports. I keep it a buck. That's how I feel. I'm keeping it a buck with you.
Hey, man. That's what it's all about. We appreciate you, brother. You kept it a buck here today, and we're so glad to have you. Once again, man, DC Kai, give you an applause, brother. That was amazing. Please go check out his YouTube channel. Give him a follow, man. This guy is definitely worth all the follows and the views and everything. He's super cool, and trust me, you're going to want to hear what he's going to say this year about this special Dolphins team, man. So once again, DC Kai, thanks again, brother. Thanks for being on the show today, man. Have your wonderful evening, and we will have you back very soon.
Thanks again, man.
Anytime, brother. Take care.
All right.
Alrighty, you guys, that was DC Kai, man. One more applause. What a cool guy. That's going to do it for our second team now. Second team of the AFC East. Oh, man, we are six teams in the entire 3-and-out 8 divisions in 8 days series. We just finished up with those Miami Dolphins. And, well, next up, we're going to be taking flight as we got another newcomer here to 3-and-out, our boy Joey Jets, man. It's going to be a lot of fun talking to him about those Jets, his expectations, and, oh, yeah, Aaron Rodgers heading on over to New York. So it's going to be a lot of fun. And then, of course, finishing off the night with Patty Bax and her Buffalo Bills. It's been a fun one so far, and I hope you all enjoying it. With that said, you are listening to 3-and-out, 8 divisions in 8 days, AFC week, day number 2. Talking the AFC East, we are at the halfway point, and we come back. We are talking New York Jets. Once again, listen to 3-and-out right here on IE Sports Radio. Your refuge for all that is sports. When we come back, we're talking Jets after this.
Hey, sports fans. Are you in the market for Florida sports? or just keeping up with the latest in the panhandle? Palm Tree Sports is a dedicated audio hub to all things sports in the Sunshine State. We cover current events, big news, heavily favored opinions all across the NFL, NBA, MLB, and so much more. So come check us out every Saturday evening at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for a Down South education on Florida sports and athletics. It's hosted by yours truly, Corey Pujols, and is powered by IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hello, sports fans. It's me, your boy Larry B, and I want to walk you through the world of sports. No, no, no. Not just the mainstream major TV deal type sports, although those are important too. But let me be your guide to your journey of all sports, from college to the pros, the minors, and everything in between. Each week, we are talking sports galore with true diehards just like you from a hardcore fan's perspective that's sure to quench your thirst around leagues you may know all too well and some you may even discover here. That's right, sports fans. If you love sports of all kinds, enjoy hearing amazing sports stories, and respect all sports because you know how difficult any of them can be to play or compete in, then this is your show. Join me, your boy Larry B, on The Defining Moment each week here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports, and let the sports come to you.
Sports fans, do you like teams that are tough, cities that are tougher, and fan bases that are passionate about their teams? How about teams that are historic and stadiums that are iconic? Then you belong in Chicago, and you need to check out Chi-Town Weekly. Join me, Adam Kernan, every week as we keep up with all things Chicago sports. Bears, Bulls, Blackhawks, Cubs, White Sox, we'll cover them all, plus more. The Windy City is always buzzing, and we'll keep you up on all the big games and major stories. So tune in to Chi-Town Weekly every week right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Welcome back, football fans. Well, here we are, day number two, AFC East Day, here on AFC Week, here on Three and Out, 8 divisions in 8 days. Oh, my gosh, that's a mouthful. With me, your boy Larry B, here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. This has been a great series so far. Yesterday, the AFC West was a lot of fun. Today, we're talking AFC East. We just finished up with Mikey earlier, one of our very own here at IE Sports Radio, Mikey Two Guns, talking Patriots. Then we just talked Dolphins. Oh, that was a lot of fun. And, well, here we are now getting into the second half of the show as we're ready to talk about them Take Flight Jets. These guys are excited. My goodness, they are ready to go, and well, from what I'm seeing so far from the fan base, these guys are really, really hyped up. Rodgers, man, I mean, what more could you want right now? And well, here to help me talk about these Jets here today, he is diehard New York Jets fan. Ladies and gentlemen, welcoming Joey Jets. What's going on, brother? How you doing today, man?
What's up, buddy? How are you?
I'm doing the best I can, man. Trust me. Having fun and love doing these interviews, and glad I could have you on tonight, man. You, I know it's kind of late over there, but you definitely made time, and I certainly appreciate you.
Hey, same here, man. It's awesome. Glad to be here.
Hey, well, let's do this, brother. So, all right, let's just go ahead and throw this out there, man. The Jets last year. So, the Jets had themselves, you know, they had themselves a year. It was a, whatever you want to call it, the Jets had a 7-10 year. Okay, let's get that out of the way. It wasn't the best. I'm a Raider fan, so I'm used to having records that have the smaller number in front. Trust me. Regardless, 2-4 in the AFC East. But let's start things off and just get a quick little recap. It was a tough night, man. Tough night for you guys in week number one versus Baltimore. Tough loss, but then you pick it up the very next week, getting a nice victory over Cleveland. You lose it to the Bengals, who would, my goodness, go on to the AFC Championship that year, and you fought them well. Then the Jets would open it up, man. 1, 2, 3, 4 game winning streak over the Steelers, the Miami Dolphins, the Packers, and the Denver Broncos, man. You guys went off, had a great little streak. Then you lost a tough one to your guys' best friends, the New England Patriots. Then you went on and got a nice little victory over some more of your guys' best friends, the Buffalo Bills. How good that must have felt since they had such a good season. You had a bye week. You lost a very tough one in New England, a very slow defensive game, a victory over the Chicago Bears. And then it's just like that nice little streak that happened in the very beginning of the, well, in the, you know, in the beginning, the first half of the year, it just went in reverse, man. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 losses to end off the year to Minnesota, Buffalo, Detroit, Jacksonville, Seattle, and Miami. It was a tough year, but Joey Jets, man, talk to us, brother. Give us every raw emotion throughout last season, man. Tell us what you felt, and let us know what you thought of the team last year.
Well, I got to be honest. Last year, when we were in the draft, I was very, very – I was hopeful that we were going to go edge rusher in the first round. I am so ecstatic that we actually went with Sauce Gardner. It was an amazing pick. It just transformed our defense. Sauce Gardner and then Garrett Wilson at number 10, Jermaine Johnson at 26, trading back up, Breece Hall in the second round. Just unbelievable draft. The season itself was, it was an up and down. It was a roller coaster. You know, we're sitting there at 5-2 going, oh, my God, this is amazing. And then Breece gets hurt. EVT gets hurt in the Denver game. And we're like, oh, what's going to happen here? And then just the bottom fell out at that point. It's amazing that we actually beat Buffalo with Zach Wilson throwing for 150 yards. Considering if he throws that in any other game, we're probably going to lose that game. Probably right now. And it was tough. It was a tough way to – you start 7-4. You think you're going to make the playoffs. You watch every game. You see Braxton Berrios drop that touchdown in the end zone in Minnesota. You think that this team's going to make the playoffs the way they're playing, and it just falls apart. But, I mean, that's almost Jets football. You almost expect the worst possible outcome. But we're hopeful this year. We're hopeful this year with Aaron Rodgers and Alan Lazard, and a better roster in general. We're hopeful that we're gonna turn the corner, and 2023 is gonna be a year that we can at least win the division title and go from there.
Well, I'll tell you, man, it wasn't too long before. I mean, my goodness, I don't know. I mean, you're on. Are you out in New York? Are you out in New York, Joey?
I'm originally from Brooklyn. I live in South Florida now, so I live in Dolphins territory.
Oh, which boy.
I live where the Dolphin fans love to just say everything. I spent 1972, and I tell them, hey, what have you done in my lifetime? Because you haven't done anything in my lifetime. They haven't done anything in my lifetime either. So we're pretty about even right now.
I love it. I love it. Well, sorry about that, Joey. Sorry about that, man. What was that? Go ahead and finish up.
No. So, they love to chant 1972, perfect season. I'm like, okay, that's fine. Hey, I was -16 when that happened. What have you done since I've been alive? What have we been done since you've been alive? Nothing either. you know, we have more playoff wins, but you guys haven't done anything. We haven't done anything. So let's actually see how it goes. I think the Dolphins and the Jets, honestly, are the top two teams in the AFC East right now. I think Buffalo's going to take a little bit of a step back. New England's going to sit there in the fourth spot. And it's going to be Jets-Dolphins as long as everyone's healthy. It's going to be a really, really good AFC East race this year.
Oh, man. I'm looking forward to it. I love it. I love how you, I love the trash talking already. I love the how you feel. Because we're going to get to that in a little bit. But, man, great stuff. And that's – okay, so we see you're originally from Brooklyn, which I'm just saying, man, look, I'm sure that you know who Emeril Lagasse is, okay? You know, bam.
Hey.
Exactly. And I remember seeing, like, what was it, like 2004, like 2000, around there, when he had the Jets offensive line, and he had Curtis Martin in there, and he was cooking, like, on the show, you know, Emeril Live and everything, and you guys were pretty damn good. Then I remember in 2010, of course, we remember the Mark Sanchez run, you guys, all the way to the AFC Championship. So, I mean, I just, you know, the Jets, it's crazy, because everyone likes to diss them, but... It's like you guys have had some solid teams over the last couple decades. So I'm just saying it was a down decade for you this one, you know, this last past decade. But here we are, and there's every reason to believe now. Look what you guys went and did. So let's go ahead and get right on into that, Joey Jets. Let's do this, man. So let's get the elephant out of the room. You already brought him up once already tonight. Aaron Rodgers heading on over to the New York Jets. Then, of course, we have... Another big pickup. I think Adrian Amos was pretty damn good. Wes Schweitzer, I think, is a big-time pickup there. Randall Cobb, of course, heading over to the Jets, as you already mentioned. Lazard. I mean, you guys got a lot of freaking talent, man. Mecole Hardman, I mean, that to me was huge. He was amazing in Kansas City. He's a damn good player in Georgia. Damara Crockett heading on over. I mean, the list goes on, man. I mean, you guys... got some major pickups, and I am so excited to see these guys wear them Jets uniforms and go out there and play to their full potential, man. So, but then again, there were some, you know, departures that we can bring up. Of course, how could I forget? Of course, Quentin Jefferson as well coming on over, but some tough departures. Okay, I get it. Braxton Berrios, you know, he's on his way out. Heading on over to the Dolphins. So he's going, you know, to your neck of the woods at the moment, you know, you guys are, let's see, who else did you guys lose? Oh, Elijah Moore is headed out. You guys would lose, there's a few other players but that I could think of. But regardless, look, there were some tough losses, some tough drops there. But same as that time, I think, personally, your pickups overweigh your guys' departures. But go ahead and talk about those Joey Jets. Tell us your biggest pickups and your biggest departures from your opinion through this offseason.
Oh, for sure. I mean, the departures, we'll start with those. Braxton Berrios, I'm okay with that. You know, there was a huge gathering to kind of re-sign him last year. And he did really well in 2021. And the fact that he just regressed so much in 2022 was just astounding. The pass that he dropped in the end zone against Minnesota, the game that he would have won the game with that touchdown pass on fourth down, that's so sick in my head. That's just amazing. The fact that he went to Miami, hey, him, Mike White, let him go to Miami. That's fine. Miami can sign all our rejects. That's no problem. We lost, really, when you think about it, Sheldon Rankins. That's our biggest loss, in my opinion. Elijah Moore, I loved Elijah Moore. I was hopeful all year long in 2022 that we were going to actually open up the offense and start, you know, passing him the ball, getting him involved. This jersey, this number 8, is actually an Elijah Moore jersey. I bought it in 2021. I was able to get it changed to an Aaron Rodgers through a third-party company that actually changed the nameplate this past offseason, which was amazing. But I loved Elijah Moore. I was hoping he would stay part of this team, but they did not use him right. Also, at the same time, Mike LaFleur didn't use him right. But going into this 2023, Alan Lazard, Mecole Hardman, keeping Corey Davis, bringing in Adrian Amos when Chuck Clark got hurt, just the signings, the way that they're building this team to actually compete this year, and maybe even next year, too, because it's like a 2-3 year window when you think about it. As long as Rodgers is here, there's a window for this team to legitimately win, and they're doing it. They're building it. I love between the draft, the free agency, the guys that are already here, Breece Hall coming back, the talks of Dalvin Cook potentially joining this team if it's a decent enough contract. I'm all for it. I love the fact that this team is actually a destination for players now instead of just saying, oh, yeah, I'm going to go if they give me money. No, they actually want to come here. It hasn't happened in years, at least 12 years, since Hard Knocks 2010. Ben, it's honestly amazing.
You hit it on the head. That you got it so correct, man. This team, people want to be there now. And you look at who you got. Look at the talent you're bringing in. Let's just go ahead and jump on into the draft. I mean, might as well. Great segue. Will McDonald, man. Look, if there were unhappy Jets fans out there, I get it. This maybe wasn't like that, you know, big time, whatever kind of pick. I get it. But to me, this was freaking huge, okay? Defensive lineman myself, I love this pickup. Will McDonald is a total badass. He is everything you want, man. He's a hard worker. Iowa State has produced some pretty solid athletes in the last couple of years. Well, you know, last decade or so. And I think he's, you know, what you need. You already have, your offense is looking really, really nice. So why not go get a dude who's going to hunt all the other quarterbacks? I mean, it makes so much sense. And then you go up next round, in the second round, Joe Tippmann, center out of Wisconsin. The dude is a stud. I love his ability. He is a damn good pass blocker. The guy's also a very solid run blocker as well. You know, I mean, I don't know if he's going to be in depth, if they're going to move him around, wherever they're going to put him, starter, I don't know. But all I know is the guy is, he can totally help out immediately somewhere. The guy is pretty damn good. You know, then of course we get into the later rounds, and I'm not going to go through every one of them, but, you know, Carter Warren, a big boy, offensive lineman out of Pittsburgh, adds some more depth. Why not? Israel Abanikida, I'm going to butcher his name. It's Abanikanda, I believe, running back out of Pittsburgh. I mean, you guys signed some solid players. Zaire Barnes, linebacker out of Northwestern. But I'll tell you right now, Western Michigan, sorry. But there's a lot of good talent you guys picked up in the draft. And I think you got exactly what you needed. That's the point of the draft. You got what you needed. And that's my personal thoughts. But Joey Jets, it's on to you, man. Tell us, what are your thoughts? How do you feel you guys did this year in the draft? Did you love it? Did you hate it? I mean, what did you think?
I was happy. I mean, I was very surprised. I think along with a lot of the Jets fans with the Will McDonald pick, I think I was with everybody else that we were like, what? Seriously? That's what we're doing. But once you see the stats, once you see like the tape on him, it was a great pick. I mean, sitting there at 15, you trade back from 13 with the Aaron Rodgers trade. New England does their whole little deal to move back and allow Pittsburgh to take the offensive lineman. You know, Belichick just wants to screw us over every single time he can. That's fine. Hey, it is what it is. Tippmann in the second round, amazing pick. That's going to be the pick of the draft. Izzy Abanikanda in the fifth round, I love it. Kuntz in the seventh, you stash him on the practice squad. He's probably the fourth tight end behind Ruckert at this point. It was a good draft. I mean, 2022 draft was the draft for Joe Douglas. You know, between Sauce and Garrett, Jermaine Johnson, Breece Hall, that's almost unheard of. The fact that he was able to get four first round talents in the first 36 picks is amazing. But I'm happy with this draft. I'm happy with how he added to the team that we have right now. And I believe that with what he added with the free agents and what we already have on this roster, this is a team that's built to win in the next 2-3 years. Legitimately, this is the window.
I'll tell you right now, I can see that. I can totally see that. This is a strong football team at the moment. How strong will they be? We got to see it first, but from what we see right now, they have every piece. This team has no excuses to not be a pretty damn solid team. So I love what I see so far. The draft, you're absolutely right, man. They won with picking, you know, I mean, winning the draft overall, you know, I mean, that's a different story, but you got, like I said, you guys got what you needed, and that is the point. So great stuff there. So Joey, let's go ahead and jump on in to this year, man. I'm looking at the schedule at the moment, and oh my gosh, I mean, look at this. We have, of course, as we know, the good old AFC East you guys play in, but who else is in there this year? Well, let's take a look. So it looks like you guys got the NFC East, and if I'm not mistaken, it is the NFC East and, oh, it would be the AFC West with my beloved horrible Raiders in there. So I will tell you right now, this looks like a fun schedule. It does. It looks like a lot of fun. You know, you guys got a lot of competition in here, but with as good as this team has gotten, I mean, you guys can compete. Look at this. You guys got, let's see here, the Dallas Cowboys are up in there, you know, Buffalo. I mean, I see these guys in here starting the season off. But overall, this is, you know, not for me to say. It's for you to say. So, Joey, yes, going into the season, what are you expecting? What are your 1,000% realist expectations for your Jets this year?
Realistically, I really hope that we come out on September 11th on Monday Night Football and we just smack the living hell out of the Buffalo Bills on Monday Night Football. Need to come out there and just make a statement. Enough with the slow starts. Enough with the oh yeah, you know, we'll start 0-3 and then we'll just build up in the middle of the season. Enough with that. Let's come out. Aaron Rodgers just shoves it down their throats. Quinton Williams sacks Josh Allen a couple of times. You know, maybe we'll strip the ball out of Stephon Diggs' hands, you know, like we did Tyreek Hill last year. That'd be amazing. I'm hopeful that we can make a statement in the division, because last year, you know, we were mediocre. You know, we still couldn't put up points against New England. Even with a remotely decent offense, we would have been probably at least 2-3 more wins. We could have been a playoff team last year, even with 7-10, with the way we started. But I really feel that, you know, with Aaron Rodgers back there, you know, actually a competent quarterback, you know, making the moves, making the decisions with it's just amazing offense, a healthy offensive line, and a defense that's not going to have to be on the field all game because the offense is actually going to move the ball, chew up time, and actually score some points. That's going to help the defense even more. It's just going to be a complimentary football game all week long, every single week. I'm hopeful, honestly, with this roster, if it's healthy, I legitimately see 12, maybe even 13 wins on this game, on this schedule. I'm going to say 12-5, just being, you know, a pessimistic guy. 12-5, you know, maybe we get the division title. Maybe we squeak in as a wild card. But I'm tired of playing second fiddle, third, fourth fiddle at this point. We sit there, we lose the division every single year. I want us to actually be that team that, you know, oh, we don't want to play them. We actually do not want to play the Jets. I want us to be that team that is feared every single week. And I think that's possible. You know, if we're healthy and then moving at the right dynamic, it's going to be that way this year. This is a 12-5, 13-4 team if healthy.
I love it. That's who the Jets should be. Look at the players they have now. Look at Aaron Rodgers. Look at this defense. Yes, the Jets can do this, but once again, we got to see it. And I love how your expectations are. I want to be that team that's feared. Look at who the Patriots were. You were in the same division as these Patriots for two damn decades when they dominated. And I mean, you guys had a couple seasons in there where you took it and you did really well. But you know, why not us, right? And that's the cool part about knowing your team in and out, because you have all this confidence, but you look at the roster and it backs it up. You know what I mean? So you know your team, man. And I'm so excited for you guys, because I really feel like the Jets, if these guys go out there and play the way that we know they can, the Jets are going to be scary.
Oh, for sure. I can't wait. I cannot wait for week one. It can't come soon enough at this point.
Yeah, everybody, I'm telling you, man, I've been recording these darn interviews all day long. That's what I'm getting every single day, and that's exactly how I feel, man. We're knocking on August's door right now, and we're like, man, we just want to see what we got in the field in August, and then September, let's go, man. Let's make this happen. So I'm excited. So anyway, brother, it has been so great. Joey Jets, you're the man, man. Thank you so much for making time. I know it's late over there for you right now, but hey, thanks again for being here. Of course, pre-recorded interviews for all of these shows, and these awesome people take the time out of their nights, sometimes super early, sometimes super late, sometimes on a whim, but I appreciate you all. Thanks again, man, for being here, Joey. Now, this is your final segment here, and this one is always so much fun. There are three other teams in your division that you kind of can't stand, and the best part is they can't stand your team right back. You know, you gotta love the rivalries, and that's what it's all about. It's a little segment we like to call Stick It To Them. Now, you can be mean and ugly, you can be nice and respectful, you can be somewhere in between. All thoughts, comments, opinions, and everything are their own here on IE Sports Radio. So, you know, don't get too crazy, but hey, let us know what you think and how you feel. So, what you're going to do is you're going to take a look at all three of your other, you know, the other three teams in your division, and let me know how you think they're going to do this year. Give me, you know, you got to give me records. You can tell me whatever you want to, but let me know how you think the rest of the division is going to do this year. And, hey, it's okay to sprinkle a little bit on top and tell us how you really feel about those teams. So you already started earlier with the Dolphins. So, like I said, you know, be harsh. Don't get too crazy, but have fun. Without further ado, Joey Jets, stick it to them.
All right, man, let's go. Let's do this. New York Jets. This is the year. This is the roster that we've been hoping for, that we've been dreaming of. We have a quarterback that actually knows how to move a football, that can actually just move an offense on his own. Doesn't need a coordinator. Doesn't actually do it with his own mind, with his own body. We don't need someone else to say, oh, yeah, we'll play you, Colin. Here we go. This is the year we're actually going to move some freaking football. This is actually going to win some games. This year, the AFC East is going to be New York Jets, Miami Dolphins, Buffalo Bills, New England Patriots. The Patriots will finish in fourth place in the AFC East this year. I don't know what record they're going to be, but I guarantee, I am putting it right now, the Patriots will be the fourth place team in the AFC East right now. I don't care what happens. Last year, if you look at it, if the Jets would have scored a touchdown, just a touchdown, if we would have had Aaron Rodgers' stats last year at quarterback, his down year, if his down year would have been our starting quarterback stats, we would have won both those games. It's remarkable how bad our quarterback play has been, just to a mediocre year for him. It's astounding. It's going to be Jets, Dolphins, Bills, Patriots. The Bills are going to take a step back this year. Jets, Dolphins, Bills, Patriots in the AFC East. The Jets will win the AFC East. It might come down to the last week of the season. I know for myself, I will be there in November, November 6th. Jets, Chargers, Monday Night Football at MetLife. I cannot wait. It's going to be amazing. Jets, Dolphins, I go just about every year when it comes down to South Florida. I will be there as well, middle of December. I can't wait. It's just going to be a hell of a year. This is the best season, the most excited I've been for a Jets season since 2010. I should lie, 2011, when I thought we were going to rebound after 2010, and it was just a heartbreaker. But we're rebounding from that. This is a competent front office. This is a competent team, competent coaching staff. We're actually going to rebuild, and this time we have a quarterback that's actually going to move the football and bring us to where we need to be. This is the time. Jets football, let's go, baby.
Yeah, let me hit that applause button for you, brother, because that was awesome. Great job telling everybody how you really feel, and that's what it's all about, man. Be a fan, show how much you love your team, and great stuff there. Joey Jets, man, you've been amazing, brother. Please let all these Jets fans listening right now know where they can find you. Anything you do, man. No, you know, we don't got a podcast or anything, but anything, any social media you want to share, whatever you want to say, man, to the Jets fans, let them know.
I mean, I'm not a big social media guy, but on Twitter, I am at JoeyJets1188. That's JoeyJets1188. Yeah, not a big YouTube guy or anything like that. I do have Facebook. I'm not too huge on that, but I do tweet here and there. So JoeyJets1188. I share my thoughts, just random rants about sports and everything like that. But yeah, that's where I'll be. And this is where it's going. This is what's going to happen. It's going to be the Jets AFC East champions 2023. Mark it right now. July 23rd, 2023. The Jets winning the division.
I love it, man. Well, Joey, you have been great, man. You have really, like I told you, you have really shook it up, really showing us, you know, what those Jets can be this year. And I loved it, man. Great stuff. Thank you so much again for being on tonight's show. We're definitely going to have you back, man. I can't wait to have you back on the show. But thanks again for everything. You have you a great night, sir. And we will talk soon.
For sure. I can't wait, man. Can't wait to be back whenever you want. Yeah, man, I'm here. Let's go, Jets, baby.
Let's go. Take care, brother. Have a great night.
You too.
Thank you, sir. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Joey Jets, once again, give him an applause. That was awesome. This guy is great. And certainly high expectations for his Jets. And why not, man? When you got Aaron Rodgers at quarterback, why the freak not? When you got all that talent coming in, why the freak not? So, great stuff there. Awesome starting out there. Well, not starting out, but a good start to the show, man. We've had a good one today. I mean, they've all been great. They're all going to be great. Yesterday was awesome. Today was awesome. And we're going to have plenty more awesome shows to come in 8 divisions in 8 days. But we just finished up with the Jets. We talked Patriots already. We talked Dolphins. And coming up, you know who we're talking, Buffalo Bills. So, once again, you were listening to 3 and Out, 8 divisions in 8 days, AFC Week Day number 2, AFC East Day, right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. When we come back, we're talking Bills after this.
Welcome to the 305, aka the Magic City, and this is Magic City Scoreboard. I'm your host, JB, and right here we're going to talk anything Miami. Miami Dolphins, Miami Heat, Miami Hurricanes, Marlins, Panthers, into Miami, and even high school football. So join me once a week right here on Magic City Scoreboard on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed to all that is sports.
What's happening, sports fans? Are you a fan of Southern California sports? Are you looking for a show hotter than a hot summer day in California? Then look no further than the SoCal Supreme Sports Show, where I talk about all things Southern California sports. That's right, all sports teams from Southern California. From the hard-hitting tackles of the NFL, to the killer crossovers and big three-pointers of the NBA and WNBA, to the grand slams of the MLB, to the bone-chilling goals of the NHL, and to the booming kicks of the MLS, the SoCal Supreme Sports Show has it all for you. Oh, and let us not forget about the college sports as well. So join me, Taryn Rodriguez, every week here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Welcome back, football fans. Well, here we are once again in day number 2 of AFC week here on 3 and Out, 8 divisions in 8 days. My goodness, where does time go? Yesterday, we took care of the AFC West. Today, we are 3 teams in to the AFC East. We talked those Patriots with our very own Mikey Two Guns of our bleeping city here on IE Sports Radio. Then we had 2 newcomers talking Dolphins with DC Kai, super cool dude. And of course, talking Jets, just finished up the Jets with Joey Jets. So awesome interviews all day long. But here we go one more time. And I mean, hey, it wouldn't be wrong to say the best for last, because last year they were certainly the best. Can they do it again this year? We shall see. But here to help me out to talk about these Buffalo Bills, lots of you out there are probably grinning because you know exactly who it is, because I'm grinning right now because, well, it's no secret who this person is. But ladies and gentlemen, she is the host of the Buffalo Huddle, one of the most, my goodness, if you just want a show to touch your heart and your fandom in the same exact hour, this is the place you want to be. Trust me, this is such a good show. And every single time I possibly can, I plug this thing. It's just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful hour every Tuesday evening. So trust me, Bills fan or not, if you just want a really good sports show that really does have a twist on it, as she says, Buffalo sports with a twist, trust me, you're going to want to check it out. Great interviews. My gosh, I can still hear Tony's interview last week, I believe. It's really good stuff. But ladies and gentlemen, she is none other than host of the Buffalo Huddle here on IE Sports Radio and IE Sports Radio Hall of Famer. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Patty Bax. What's going on, Patty? Good evening.
Thank you so much, Larry. Oh, my goodness. I'm totally humbled, and I'm probably redder than I am from the sunburn I got yesterday. Oh, no. after that introduction. That was so wonderful, and it's really an honor and privilege to be here and to represent my beloved Buffalo Bills.
Well, Patty, you are definitely very welcome. You do an amazing job every week here on IE Sports Radio, and I'm telling you, your fandom just shines through and through. We've had you on this network for years now, so many years that we had to give you your own show because you lived here basically. So that's just how it works, and we're so glad to have you here. No one covers the Buffalo Bills like you. You know, I know there, you mentioned before, we're talking off air right now, there's a lot of Buffalo Bills podcasts. I'm not throwing shade at anybody, but I will say, Patty, yours is at the top, and I'm sure every one of you Bills fans out there have awesome shows, but this woman, I don't know. Nobody tops her. She's amazing. She does a great job, and just wonderful work every single week, Patty. So, gotta tell you,
thank you, Larry.
Oh, you are very welcome. So, gotta tell you, these Bills are looking real good this year after a really good year last year. So, we're gonna start things off with, and I know it was a good one. Actually, it was a great one. Unfortunately, the way it ended was a little tough. But we're gonna go ahead and recap that crazy season from last year that ended in just heartbreak. But, Patty, you guys started out with a very – everyone said the Rams. Well, you guys completely destroyed the Super Bowl champion from 2021. Absolutely destroyed them, okay? 31-10 in that first game for kickoff. And that was just a head-turner because – if you did that to the Rams, what were the Bills going to do to everybody else? And my gosh, it was a season. Went on to the very next game, simply destroyed Tennessee. Then this was just the weirdo. You guys head over to Miami, lose a tough one because even the Patriots, I don't know what it is about that stadium, but Miami just, they got something going there. Regardless, they get a victory over you guys there. Okay, tough going.
But they built the stadium so that the visitors have to suffer
in the sun. Heat.
Yes. And it was, I mean, when you had Stefon Diggs laying on the ground with IVs in both arms to hydrate him, that's, to me, that's like life-threatening. They really, if they're going to have summer games, especially with the way that the heat's been this year right now, I think they're going to have to really consider doing night games when it comes to September in Miami.
Yeah, that's a tough one, and it really is very hot over there. So that's crazy. So you guys would come up just short, 21-19. But then, Patty, you guys would go on a terror. You guys would absolutely go on a terror. Yeah. You would win four games in a row, defeating Baltimore, Pittsburgh, the Kansas City Chiefs, And then, of course, a bye week. You went into the bye week nice and happy. Went on over. Actually, Green Bay came over to you guys. You guys handled them well. And then there was this weird little period. You lose one to the Jets. I'm still trying to figure out what happened. And then, you and me both. Yeah, that was just an odd game. Regardless, I don't know. That was just a New York kind of game, I guess. There's a New York on New York game. I don't know.
New Jersey. We call them New Jersey.
We're
the only New York State team. Just want to make that clear.
It's so true because, yeah, East Rutherford is where these Jets play, and that is not in the state of New York. So.
Correct. You know your geography. Very good.
Thank you very much. So the people who use the name, the New York Jets, tough game there. Then one of the most oddest games I think we've seen all year last year. The Minnesota Vikings come to town. You guys lose an incredibly crazy, weird 33-30 overtime game. Regardless, you guys took that and ran because you would win six in a row, defeating the Browns, the Lions, the Patriots, the Jets. Hey, what's up, Jets? And the Miami Dolphins. And guess what? That was payback for both those other games. Taking out the Bears and then tragedy would strike on one of the most horrific things we've ever seen in a football game. I mean, I still can remember sitting there with my wife right after New Year's, watching this game on January 2nd and saying, cancel the freaking game. I mean, oh my gosh. It was unfortunately a horrible ordeal that took place, but thank God DeMar Hamlin is completely fine. Everyone knows it was a happy ending to a very terrible game. However, the game was canceled. Okay, goodbye. Don't even need to look at it. You know, I mean, that was bigger than football. It was
the right thing to do. It was definitely the right thing to do.
It was the right thing to do because that was much bigger than football or any other sport. So thankfully that happened and, thankfully it was canceled, and that was it. We all went our merry way. There were lots of talks about, okay, what's going to happen? How is the playoff implications? Both these teams are playoff teams. Okay, so we figured it out. Cool. You guys head back home. Welcome New England. You took them out again for a second time that year, swept them. Then it was the wild card. Okay, so you guys get the wild card, and your best friends, the Miami Dolphins, come on over to Buffalo, and, well, you take them out. It was a good one because Miami definitely fought, but the Bills had the upper hand that game, took them out, and what happens the very next game? You welcome over those Cincinnati Bengals, and you know what? I can still remember you telling me all those months ago that they were just spent. What happened last year? Because there's so much more. And, Pat, if you want to elaborate on all that, please do. But this community, this team, it was so much wear and tear on the Bills last year that unfortunately when they got to the stage, the playoffs, they just didn't have it. It was a very tough year, and I salute all of you over there in Buffalo for enduring what you did. But just what a run, though. Unfortunately, let's just cut to the chase. You guys would lose 27-10 and fall just short of the AFC Championship. Of course, we all know the rest of the story, right? The Chiefs would defeat the Bengals, and then the Chiefs would go on to defeat the Eagles in the Super Bowl. Okay, cool. But when it comes down to it, you guys fizzled out because of just – it was a very rough year. So, Patty, please go over that entire season. Let all the emotion out. I mean, let us know, how was it last year as a Bills fan?
Well, this is not fiction. This is fact. Last season – and I really believe it, never in the history of the NFL did a team go through as much as the Buffalo Bills. Not only the players, the coaches, the staff, the whole city, the community, everyone who's a Bills fan. And there were 10 major things that happened. And when I read this list, imagine yourself being a Bills fan, or if this happened to your team. So it all started on May 14th. A mass shooting occurred in Buffalo at a Tops Friendly Market. It's a supermarket on the East Side neighborhood. And 10 people, all of whom were Black, were murdered, and 3 were injured. Luke Knox, brother of Buffalo Bills Dawson Knox, tight end, and a Florida International University football player. He died at 22 in August. His roommates found him in his room. Co-owner and president of the Bills, Kim Pegula, went into cardiac arrest, and there wasn't a word said about, nobody knew what happened to her until her daughter, almost a year later, disclosed what happened. We had the November blizzard where the Bills game was actually moved to Detroit, and then they had to go back again to Detroit on Thanksgiving 3 days later. We had the season-ending injuries to Von Miller and Micah Hyde. We had Josh Allen trying to play through a partially torn UCL along with related tendon and muscle injuries during the second half of the season. And he suffered the injury in the Bills' Week 9 loss to the Jets. We had the Christmas blizzard where the team was stuck. They couldn't get home for Christmas Eve after the Chicago game. And 39 people died in Buffalo. 72 mile per hour winds at the Buffalo airport on December 23rd, according to the National Weather Service. 4 feet of snow accumulated in parts of Erie County over the course of 5 days. It didn't end until December 27th, so everybody's Christmas was pretty much canceled. The highest snowfall was reported at the Buffalo airport, where the Bills couldn't even fly into the Buffalo airport. They had to fly into Rochester, which is about an hour and a half drive away. And the snow at the airport was 51.9 inches. Now imagine, after being stranded in Chicago on Christmas, after crushing the Bears, 35-13, had to put that in, Adam Karnick, finding themselves unable to fly directly back to Buffalo. They needed to take a bus from Rochester to the airport. So they get back to the airport, and guess what? Their cars are buried under the 52 inches of snow. So they needed help shoveling out. However, there was a travel ban, but neighbors close by to the airport all came and helped them shovel out. Then we had longtime Bills announcer John Murphy had a stroke. And then, of course, DeMar Hamlin going into cardiac arrest. Now, imagine being a fan of a team that went through all of this, or a player or coach or staff member. And despite all of this, the Bills won the AFC East and finished 13-3, because they didn't finish the Cincinnati game. So that's why it's 16, not 17. And Josh Allen, even with an injury, his stats were incredible. He had 4,283 yards. He had 35 TDs, and he rushed for 762 yards. So that is amazing to me. And by the time they went to play the Bengals in the playoffs at home, they were spent. And I know, as a fan, I felt it. So I can only imagine what the players were going through and the coaches. And in my opinion, because I have said on my show a couple of times, I have a master's in counseling education, and I did work as a counselor for 20 years. When they saw the Bengals, it really triggered a post-traumatic stress response. And they had nothing left in the tank. It was literally like, you know, think about if you've ever had, hopefully you haven't, but, you know, if you've had something traumatic happen to you and something that reminds you of that, you see it or you experience it again, it's going to bring back all those feelings and emotions. So how could they actually go out and play a game when they were seeing the players that the last time they saw them was when we didn't know if DeMar was going to live or not? So that, to me, kind of sums up last season. I mean, that was an incredible season, and what they learned and will take into, I believe, 2023-2024 is they're a team with camaraderie, strength, and resiliency that no other team in the NFL possesses. And German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche said, "What doesn't kill you makes you stronger." And I think they didn't ask for any of that to happen, but it will make them a much stronger team because of what they did endure and the lessons that they learned.
Patty, that was just listening to that, just like, my gosh, that mentally exhausted me just hearing all of these terrible things. So, yeah, I mean, I played this game a long time, and you know, it's crazy because it is so true when they say it is 90% mental, because it's so true, Patty. When there's something else that's just bigger, that's just there, the concentration, and that can go into anything, not just football, but anything. When
there's absolutely.
Right? I mean, it doesn't matter, but, you know, it doesn't matter if you never played the game to any of our listeners, any out there. I mean, you all know. I mean, go ahead. Try to take a huge exam with something that's bothering you. You're not going to perform. Go ahead and take a I don't know. Whatever it is you're doing. I mean, I can't even think of things at the moment. But what I'm saying is, yeah, I can totally see that. And, you know, it's crazy. I knew about half of those things. I really didn't know too much detail on the rest of it or even any of those at all when you went into detail right now about all of those things. So I can just imagine just the wear, the tear, the of course, the game with the Bengals. I mean, people will say what they want to say. People are mean. People are going to say, oh, this and that and, boo-hoo or whatever. But at the end of the day, look. That's a human. These are all human people. These are all humans. Mm-hmm. These are human lives. These are just the way. I mean, I couldn't imagine the whole Christmas Eve thing, the blizzard, the deaths. I mean, just how sad this was, you know. But if you think about it, this team is so resilient. And that's why I'm telling you, Patty, this team is special. The city is special. It's, you know, you guys battle the elements up there, something that I know nothing about here in Southern California, okay? The closest I've ever gotten to, like, a good snow is going up to the mountains over here in Southern California. And it's funny because you guys probably look at this snow over here and go, that's snow? You know, because it's true, you know? I mean, your guys' snow is like a ocean compared to our puddle of snow, you know?
Right. We do kind of laugh when, you know, some of the southern states, oh, we've closed the schools because we have an inch of snow. I'm like, okay. All right. Well, people don't know how to drive. And granted, last year was certainly an anomaly. That doesn't happen like that all the time. And yeah. We have the best summers. I mean, right now, my heart breaks for all those people that are just enduring unbearable heat conditions. We have beautiful weather right now. You know, yesterday I went for a bike ride, went to the beach. It's like 75, 85. It's low humidity. It's wonderful. And it's almost like, you know, you have to count your blessings because not everybody's experiencing this beautiful weather. So in Buffalo, we do have beautiful weather, spring, summer, and fall, and winter, you know, is for the most part, it's wonderful. And I actually love staying in the house on a snow day and reading a book or something like that, or watching old tapes of the Bills games, you know, something like that. But it's really fun. So yeah, I think you're right, though. It's certainly something that I don't think a lot of fans from other teams really realized the extent. You know, they might have just saw DeMar Hamlin and thought that's all this team went through, but there was so much more. And like you said, just listening to it, it's mentally and emotionally exhausting. I mean, even just reading it again and just recalling all those memories, it's powerful. It really is triggering too. So I have no doubt that, you know, we are so blessed with a great GM in Brandon Bean and our coach, Sean McDermott. I'm sure for them, just going through this, they never expected it when they were hired for their positions. No one wanted this to happen, but it did bring the team much closer. And I think we're going to see the fruits of the labor in this season.
Oh, I can definitely. Why not get close the door on that one and get on to that next season? That's a perfect segue.
Absolutely.
That's exactly what we're going to do. And that's exactly what the Bills are doing right now in training camp. I'm loving it. Patty, this was an eventful offseason. My goodness, I've seen players come and go all over the place. I mean, Leonard Floyd makes his way over to the Bills.
Love it.
You have Puna Ford, a guy that I absolutely, two of those guys. Why? Because I play defensive line. And you know, these two guys are freaks of nature. And may I add, you already have freaks of nature on the defensive line. Mm-hmm. So you just added more psychos. And I absolutely love it. It's disgusting and I love it. These guys are nasty. They're mean. They're tough. I mean, just adding those two guys alone just makes me a bigger fan because this defense, because they got so much better. So let's continue. Deontay Hardy is making his way over from
the
Saints. That was really cool. I was like, oh, cool. Like that's another great pickup. Brandon Shell, for those of you who don't know, pretty solid offensive lineman. Also Trent Sherfield, I believe. Also
Sherfield, yeah.
I mean, you guys, Cameron Dantzler, I mean, from the Vikings, there is a lot of players that made their way. Damian Harris, Taylor Rapp. Yes. Yep. So Connor McGovern, another guy who was a big anchor for that offensive line for the Dallas Cowboys for so many years. So, ladies and
David
gentlemen,
Edwards.
Exactly, David Edwards. So Patty, you're already starting it, and I love it. Take over, please. This is your show. So, by all means, talk about your biggest. No, don't get me wrong. There were some departures, kind of tough. Sinatieri leaving, Justin Murray heading over to my Raiders. I mean, there were some departures, but please talk about your biggest pickups and departures for the Bills this offseason.
Yeah, I would say kind of a controversial player was Tremaine Edmonds, who went to Chicago, and I'm very curious to hear what Adam Karnick is going to say on his show, Chi-Town, on Monday nights, I think he is a big departure with an asterisk because we still have Matt Milano. And if it were between the two of them, I think Matt Milano was definitely much better to keep. He's aggressive. He's quiet. He's one of those quiet players that doesn't say much off the field. He does his action on the field. But I would say, you know, we did lose Devin Singletary, who I was never crazy about. But I would definitely say our biggest additions were that we have now five players from the Rams. Now, the biggest one, I think, is veteran edge rusher, like you mentioned, Leonard Floyd. He's only signed a one-year deal, and Brandon Bean is famous for these one-year deals, which does help a lot. And I think other teams have copied this contract structure because the Bills didn't really have a lot. We were limited with our salary cap to bring in these high-priced free agents. And we didn't make any like major big splashes, but we did bring in, like you said, some very valuable pieces to add to the depth on our roster. You know, when you finish 13-3, you don't need a lot to add to the roster. So I think bringing on players that really fit the scheme. Brandon Bean looks for those players who are good fit physically and mentally. You know, we want smart players. We want players that are going to gel and fit with the camaraderie of this team. One of the things that was lacking on the offense was we couldn't protect Josh Allen. And that was a real concern last year, you know, and I think it led to him getting injured, unfortunately. So this year, what they looked to do both on the offensive and defensive lines were to bring in some bulk, bring in that height, bring in the weight. So one of the things going back, you know, we didn't talk about the draft yet, but one of the players in the draft that I could not believe he was still there when we were drafting him in the second round was the Bills drafted Florida guard offensive lineman Osiris Torrance at 59. I could not believe he was still there. In fact, I had last Sunday the pleasure to meet him in person, got a picture with him. And I told him, I said, I do a podcast, the Buffalo Huddle on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all the sports. And I told him, I said, on the podcast, I actually said, God, I didn't think we were going to be able to get you because I thought you would never be there.
No chance.
Yeah, no chance. And he was. He's 6'5" and 347 pounds. And I will tell you, he is all of 6'5", 347 pounds standing next to him. He's very well proportioned. He's equally well balanced and he's super strong. And the most incredible thing is that he's the only four-year starter who's never surrendered a single sack during his entire career. And he has played over 3,000 snaps. That is crazy to me. That's exactly the kind of player we needed to draft and bring in. We couldn't find that player you know, in free agency, but we were able to bring in, and it will not surprise me if he's a starter this year. I really could see him doing that. He's kind of reminiscent of Larry Allen of the Cowboys and 49ers. He's got very strong hands. He can consistently under the pads of, he can get under the pads of rushers, and he can do an amazing job at pass protection. He's got a lot of quickness, even though he's like over 300 pounds, but he's very, very quick. He's light on his feet. And the real interesting thing about him is he has a lot of balance and leverage, and his hand placement is excellent. What he also displays is he's really confident, and who wouldn't be confident if you've never given up a sack, right? I mean, he's amazing. He's really, he's been at both guard spots. He's regarded as a right guard prospect, but he also was very, very elite when he was a freshman. He played on the left. So I think that he's going to be in a tremendous addition to our offense. And of course, our first round draft pick as well, Dalton Kincaid. So we now have Dawson Knox, DK and DK, both tight ends. But Dalton Kincaid, I think, was another steal for the Bills. They got him at the 25th pick overall from Jacksonville in exchange for the 27th pick and pick 130 in the fourth round. So when we look at Dalton Kincaid, he is super productive as a tight end. He actually led the nation with 70 receptions and 890 yards. But what's really, I think, his biggest strength is that he is on paper a tight end, but he plays like a receiver. And he actually was a former basketball player who has tremendous smoothness. And again, just like Osiris, he's got that balance. And he is rarely caught out of position. He's very explosive off the line. He's got deep speed, and he can really create that separation against the safeties, which we could really use. And he runs the perfect routes. He's great with catching the ball. He's got soft hands. He's very much a major threat in the red zone. And he can also turn upfield and break those tackles. So a lot of yards after catch is something we're looking for. And I think he can bring that to the team. What we've seen already that is that he's developing a really great rapport, not only with Josh Allen, but also with Dawson Knox, you know, who is a better blocker. So Dalton Kincaid might have better hands than Dawson Knox, but definitely, you know, he definitely can learn to be better at blocking. But maybe we don't do it. Maybe we do a two tight end set and we have them both on the field. So lots of great options. And I think that's what's going to lead to a better season is that we brought in, I hate to disparage any of the players we had last year, but the ones that have left us, but we brought in some talent, some really good talent. We brought in a lot of players that are going to bring competition. The players that are coming from the Rams, they bring that, you know, Super Bowl mentality, which is something we can definitely never have enough of. And I think that, you know, this is going to make the team better because of the competition, because of the size, because of the bulk. And the other factor is the fact that, you know, unfortunately, we lost Leslie Frazier because he decided he needed a break. There may be some other things behind the scenes, but we'll never know about that. But we've got Sean McDermott taking over the defense. And I don't know if we want to stop there. I've done a lot of talking and maybe give you a chance to weigh in on some of that, Larry, but we can get into Sean McDermott and have some interesting thoughts about what he's going to do with this defense.
I love it. No, you can keep on going. This is great because I'm telling you, this is why you are a podcaster through and through. You took the show and ran, and that's exactly what I love. I mean, this, I couldn't have said it better. My gosh. When I seen Osiris Torrance not picked in the first round, I thought to myself, wow, there's a bunch of stupid teams. Like, I don't understand how. I mean, seriously, like, I don't understand
how. I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't believe it.
Yeah, me either. It blew my mind. Don't get me wrong, okay? Don't get me wrong. Dalton Kincaid, I'm a Pac-12 guy. I'm also a USC guy. And I got to see him beat my Trojans not once, but twice last year. So Cam Rising loved him as a target.
the guy is just so freaking hard to cover, and I watch my Trojans just have fits trying to contain this guy. I mean, he is such a talent, and I was like, wherever he goes, man, he's going to make instantly better, and wouldn't you know, he goes to the Bills. I mean, as fate would have it, and then again, as fate would have it, Patty, this is, I'm just saying, this is special. This is special, you know, and not to get too deep on any other topic or even bring in religion to it, because of course I know you and I are both believers, but I just gotta tell you right now, Patty, I just, it, look, the talent that you guys brought, it's not typical. It's not. How you guys managed to get Dalton Kincaid and Osiris Torrance slips to the second round, that doesn't happen. I'm just saying, Patty. Like,
no, look, I know. I have to pinch myself. And to meet him in person, you know, just to talk with him. It was very brief, but he's such an incredible person. And just to be there at an event, to meet the fans, sign cards, pictures, whatever. It's incredible. But there's one more player we haven't really talked about, and I think you and I both have mentioned him before. That's in the third round. Ugh. We got our first defensive pick, Tulane linebacker Dorian Williams. And I don't know, there's something special about this kid. He plays like a defensive back, but he hits like a linebacker. And he really looks the part. He's got good height. He's thick, muscular build. I mean, I've seen some pictures without his shirt on, and like, he is chiseled. He is incredibly chiseled. Long arms, good overall athleticism, and he's got great straight line speed. He's truly a gifted athlete. Very impressive frame. He's got a lot of raw ability, and he definitely, you know, has some weaknesses, but in my opinion, those can be coached. They can definitely be coached. He's got some very streaky instincts. He has excellent awareness and zone coverage. And I think we got another steal in the third round too with Dorian Williams.
Patty, I got to tell you right now, Dorian Williams, another guy. I mean, what is it with you guys picking up players that just killed me last year? I mean, Dorian Williams, I watched him and his Tulane Green Wave just not go away in our bowl game. I even forgot the name of the dang bowl game. That's how bad I want to forget it from last year with USC, Lincoln Riley's first year. And oh my gosh, seeing Tulane earn that victory over USC, and Dorian Williams, of course, a big part of it. You got to see, he got to showcase his talent that day of how good he was. And I honestly thought too, when he got into the third round, I was like, man, like, nobody picked him up yet. And lo and behold, I shouldn't have said that, because the Bills would pick him up. I'm telling you, Patty, it's, yeah. I'm just saying, I don't want to call it divine intervention. I don't know what I want to call this, but after all of the suffrage from last year, someone's looking out for you. I'm just saying, this football team.
I sure hope so.
There's too many good things that happen to this football team. And Patty, it's hard. Like I told you already, a spoiler alert to everybody else. I already said this on Patty's show about 2 months ago. But yeah, Patty, there's I'm taking the Bills this year for the win for the Super Bowl, because How do you beat this team? Look at everyone they have. They're playing with a chip on their shoulder. They're playing with every bit of angst from last year. This team is playing. Mm-hmm. They're playing to avenge a season that they knew was theirs, but unfortunately, too many bad things happen. I mean, you are so right. If anybody knows how to battle, it's the Bills. And hey, there is that old saying that no one circles the wagons like the Bills.
Wagons, right. Chris Berman, absolutely. Yes, it's not a slogan for, you know, just out of thin air. It definitely has a lot of meaning behind it.
It is so true. So Patty, I mean, by all means, go on ahead. You want to say anything else about McDermott? But I mean, yeah, this is huge. I'm so excited for you guys. And I just feel like right now, this team now, with what you have, They're so special. So, yeah, by all means, I said you want to go ahead and close that up and however you want to do it, but we'll get on to this year.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that the other piece that's really important for moving into this next season is that we're healthier. You know, we've got the secondary, Trey White, Tre'Davious White. He is really, I think, going to come back stronger. He's finally going to have a year of healing from his ACL. Kair Elam, I think he's now learned what it takes to be a great corner, and he's going to step it up. We've got, you know, an amazing secondary, Micah Hyde and Jordan Poyer, who I really didn't think was going to be able to come back. You know, all indications pointed he's leaving. And, you know, he sold his house. Everything was pointing in that direction, and lo and behold, he's back. And Micah Hyde mm-hmm. is back from his neck injury. I mean, Von Miller, what more can we say about Von? You've seen on, you know, he's posted on Instagram and Twitter some of the videos of his workout, another player who's totally chiseled, and that man could read the phone book, and I would sit and listen. He's got that mindset, that mentality that is just a winning mindset, and he brings that into this whole camaraderie. When he was of the team in this culture, which is what Sean McDermott has built and Brandon Bean over the years, and when he wasn't playing, he was coaching, and, you know, I don't know, I think I've mentioned this on my show, but when he is done with football, whenever that is, Von Miller wants to be a GM. So he has shadowed Brandon Bean. He knows what it takes to get the right players. And I have no doubt he was in his ear, Brandon's ear, helping with the draft this year and the free agents that we signed. But I think in terms of Sean McDermott, he is taking over because Leslie Frazier wasn't fired. He's just kind of on leave. But it opened a door for Sean McDermott to take over the play calling this season. And you can see the fire in his eyes in a press conference. And when he was with the Panthers, he actually did a lot of nickel formations because he was the defensive coordinator with the Carolina Panthers. And he was very aggressive. He also was with the Philadelphia Eagles, and he was aggressive there as a coach. Ron Rivera said that there is no doubt in his mind that Sean can handle both head coach responsibilities and defensive coordinator. And actually, some of the players, you know, we just had the training, not the training camps, but the OTAs, and some of them have already said they've seen a tremendous difference, change in Sean. He just seems more aggressive, like he's having fun. And I think, you know, you are a player, Larry, you've been in the trenches. You know that if you're not having fun, that if you take that element out of the game and you feel that constant pressure to perform and it's not fun, that love of the game is gone. And I think what's happened, yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And Sean is bringing it back for these players, for himself. And I think they're going to probably still have the nickel formation as their base formation. But I think they're also going to have some different looks. They're going to do maybe have a 4-3 front as a primary look. Also, they're going to be able to do a 3-4 front. And if the Bills were to play 3-4, without a doubt, you're going to have Von Miller and Leonard Floyd. And then both players have that extensive experience, you know, being on the Rams in that role. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you've got on the defensive line, you've got Greg Rousseau, who's also bulked up. And, you know, he's had a lot of experience when Von went out and Von's coached him along the way. Ed Oliver, who just signed a huge extension. And those are going to be the defensive ends. And even though Oliver is a defensive tackle, he can be explosive when he wants to be. I'm not always his best cheerleader, but he does have enough speed to get some pressure and, you know, put that pressure on the quarterback. And then you've got the nose tackle, which one of my kind of players that I really like, and I think he's sometimes overlooked, is DaQuan Jones.
Yes.
And then Jordan Phillips. He's one of my favorite players. My claim to fame is I baked Buffalo cutout cookies and shared them with Jordan Phillips in a cornhole tournament, and he loved them. So that's my awesome claim to fame for knowing Jordan Phillips.
That's awesome, Betty. Well, I'll tell you right now, yeah, that's really cool. I was a big fan of Ed Oliver back in Houston. I think Phillips is amazing. You guys have had such great success, and I know that it's going to continue on. So Patty, let's talk about this year real quick. And I love how you're bringing up the 43 and 34. Oh my goodness, having those guys, I mean, it's very simple. Just drop back your ends and scoot out your, I mean, you know what I mean,
exactly. Get a big
anchor in the middle, scoot out your ends, you know, your interiors. That's why they got to be versatile. I mean, I absolutely love it however they're gonna, they plan to do it. But Patty, this year you guys are facing none other then the, I believe it's the, oh boy, that's just great. The AFC West. Thank you so much for, thank you NFL schedulers for that. Really appreciate it. Anyway, the AFC West, and looks like the NFC East. So, you know, and of course you got the AFC East in there. You know, the teams you love to hate. And when it comes down to it, this is going to be a very fun season. Lots of competition in here. Lots of teams that have so many different builds. I mean, you guys versus the Eagles, I think that might be a Super Bowl preview. I'm just saying, because they are stacked.
Yeah.
So they have the whole Georgia roster over there on their team right now. So you guys and them, that could be it. So, I mean, this is just a very, very good roster and a really cool, really, really, really cool schedule, because there's so many games that I'm just like, oh my gosh, like I want to see this one and this one and this one. So, Patty, I mean, of course I'm going to see them all, but Patty, give it to us one more time tonight, or today, of course, the interview being recorded the night before. But, Patty, talk to us and tell us, what are your expectations this year? You already know my expectations. I think this team has it. I really do. I think they got what it takes. What do you expect from this team this year?
All right. The AFC East, we know, we've heard it over and over again. It's going to be a brutal test. We know that, because everybody's trying to be the Buffalo Bills. They're all the play, the teams in this division are trying to be us. Now, they don't have the X factor, which we do. That's Josh Allen. Now, I understand Aaron Rodgers went to the Jets, but what Aaron Rodgers is going to be the Jets quarterback this year? Is it going to be the one we saw last year? Or is it going to be one that, you know, is going into the Hall of Fame? My money is, not that I'm a betting person, but I'm going to say, we know Josh Allen beat Aaron Rodgers last year. I was there. I was at the game. It was in Buffalo. And Josh Allen is a competitor. Aaron Rodgers beat him in golf. Josh Allen holds grudges. He's not going to let Aaron Rodgers beat him again, and certainly not twice. So we know that there's changes that were made to the coaching staff, definitely with Miami, the Jets, and Patriots have all tried to go out there and get better, and they probably have gotten better. However, the Bills are still the AFC East champions. And even though, and you'll hear this in a minute, a lot of analysts are not picking us to finish first again, that's okay, because the pressure isn't on us to be first. We know what it takes to be first. It's really going to be, I think, up to a couple X factors, and that is going to be the number one, can we stay healthy? What about other teams? Can they, in our division, and then the other teams that we have to face, can they stay healthy? You know, the one game that they're coming to Buffalo, Brian Daboll's Giants, Brian Daboll knows Josh Allen, but Brian Daboll doesn't know the Josh Allen of 2023. So, you know, obviously that's going to be an exciting game, but we'll see what happens there. But overall, I'm going to predict if we stay healthy, there's no reason we can't go 14-3. If we have injuries, I think that we can still go 13-4, or maybe we can go maybe, I would say 12-5. But I think that we definitely have to just hope that the injury bug doesn't bite us like last year. But it's not going to be easy. It won't be easy. But we know, this team knows what it takes to win. And as long as we have Josh Allen, we have nothing to be afraid of. And like I said, Von Miller coming back healthy and the rest of the team being healthy, you know, we know what it takes to win.
I couldn't agree more. And Patty, one more segment before you're out of here. You're very familiar with it. It is the Stick It To Them segment, where you get to tell us how you think those other three teams are going to do this year in the AFC East, and also add a little more on top if you'd like. Patty, without further ado, stick it to them.
All right, Larry, you know I'm known for my poems, so I had a lot of fun with this one. And this poem to all the AFC East and all the doubters in the NFL is called Don't Sleep on Us. It's happening. You hear it from analysts far and wide. The Jets have a lock on first in the AFC East. The Bills are starting to slide. The window's closed on the Bills is what the so-called experts say. That team can't be number one again. The team has gone astray. Sure, Josh is back, but he's never still won the big game. Another season's passed, and isn't everything with the Bills the same? How does Bills Mafia respond to counting the Bills out? Well, we don't holler, scream, or stay in our rooms and pout. No, true Bills fans relish in the doubters who think we won't be back. The non-believers don't know this team is on the attack. The Bills survived a year like no other and gained resilience as their middle name. They're role models for humanity and aren't looking for fame. We have Josh, Steph, Greg, Dawson, Dalton, Osiris, Vaughn, and so many more. So don't sleep on us, or you'll be awakened by the Mafia's mighty roar. Underestimate us? Forget about us? Sleep on us, if you dare. Pleasant dreams? I think not. We will be your most unwelcome nightmare. Go Bills.
The applause button has been, if I had a better applause button, I would hit that thing right now. I mean, oh my gosh, again, you did it again, Daddy. Another amazing poem. I'm done. You have not, ladies and gentlemen, you don't know how many people she's knocked out in the primetime face-offs with her amazing poems, and well, here we go again. Yeah, Patty, you in literature, it is just something. It is so natural to you, and I love it. I enjoy hearing these, and I love how you string them together. I mean, you are very talented, very gifted, and yeah, what a
great, thank you. You're
very welcome. What a great way to end this segment, and this was a lot of fun. Way to go, and yeah, I mean, once again, these Bills are special. There's something special going on this year, and people can say what they will, you know, but I see this team getting it done, so this is a very, very good football team, and I think you guys gotta At least you know my opinion already, but I think you got a pretty good chance. So, Patty.
I agree.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be great. So, Patty, with that said.
Hungry and humble. That's what it is. Hungry and humble. I don't have to brag. I know what we've got. I know where we're going. We know our direction. Like I said, don't sleep on us.
And that is the most special thing. So, Patty, before you're out of here, let everybody know, all these Bills fans know where to find you, where to find your show. Anything else you want to plug, the floor is yours.
Okay, great, Larry. I can be found every Tuesday night at 7 p.m., actually tonight, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 4 p.m. Pacific Time. And you can also follow me at Twitter at Buffalo Huddle, HUDL_IE, or at Huddles 1025-1. So please join me for the Buffalo Huddle with Patty Bax every Tuesday. And thank you, Larry. It's been an honor and a privilege. I'm very humbled, and I thank you for being an honorary Bills Mafia member.
Well, you can count me in, because you guys are awesome. So I really, really appreciate that as well. Thanks for spending your time tonight. Once again, it is coming up on 1 a.m. for her over there last night, you guys. Or you can say early this morning for those of you on the East Coast. So the cool part about this show, Patty, is it's going to be ending right before the Buffalo Huddle tomorrow. So when people are listening to the end of this show, well, your show is just minutes away. So that's going to be cool.
That's awesome. That's so great. That's right? Great.
So with that said, Patty, thanks again. Get you some sleep. I'm gonna go grab me some sleep as well, but I look forward to hearing you guys hearing you tomorrow. I said you guys because I guess expect awesome guests now, I guess, you know, from you, but you do such
no guests tomorrow. No guests tonight, so
well,
just me.
just you and the awesome people in the chat room are good enough, in my opinion. So stuff as always. Patty, thanks again for stopping by tonight and making this show that much better. We appreciate you. Have a great night, and, well, we will see you tomorrow on the Buffalo Huddle.
Sounds great, Larry. Have a great night. Have a blessed night, and go Bills.
Go Bills. Thanks again, Patty. Talk to you soon.
All right. Take care, Larry.
Take care. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that was Patty Bax. My goodness, that was nearly an hour long, but Patty is awesome like that, and she can really get into her Bills, and that's what we love here, you guys, by the fans, for the fans. So, with that said, well, I've already spoiled my final weigh-in, but after this break, after this segment, I don't know why, but after this break, you will hear my final weigh-in for the remainder of the AFC East, and, well, that is that. So, man, AFC East Day has come to a conclusion, and, well, here we go. We are halfway through the AFC East. So, when we come back, y'all, we are talking about my final weigh-in of the AFC East. You are listening to 3 and Out, 8 Divisions in 8 Days, day number 2 of AFC Week, AFC East Day, right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We'll be right back with my final weigh-in on the AFC East after this.
What's up, everybody? This is Taryn Rodriguez. Are you a fan of volleyball? Are you a fan of thunderous spikes? Then I have the show for you. Set Point, where I cover NCAA men's and women's volleyball, high school boys and girls volleyball, beach volleyball, and even professional volleyball. Catch the action every week here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hello, ladies and sinners. Hello, sports fans around the world. Hello, IE Sports family. This is Cale Henderson, the host of IE Vegas, the Sin City Sports Show, presented by IE Sports Radio. If you folks are interested in sports in the Vegas area, if you're wanting to have a blast for 1 hour every Tuesday night from 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, this is a show built for the Vegas sports fans, where we feature the Las Vegas Raiders, the Las Vegas Golden Knights, the Las Vegas Aces, and the University of Las Vegas, Nevada Rebels. Hopefully, fingers crossed, MLB team coming soon. Either way, if you folks are looking to have a blast for 1 hour each and every week, tune in Tuesday, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. If you folks are interested in Vegas sports news, go to our Twitter, at SinCities_IESR, and you can speak with me, the host, Cale Henderson, at Cale_Henderson on Twitter. At any time, be happy to reply. Always willing to reach out to our fans. Again, the Sin City Sports Show, presented by IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Hey, yo, what's up? It's your man Bishop, the voice of This Is KC Sports, the show where we go over the Chiefs, the Royals, KC Current, Sporting KC, MU, and oh yeah, if we got time, we'll even throw in some of that KU stuff for my people on the 913 South. Come hang out with us every Sunday, 2 p.m. Central Standard Time on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Are you a fan of Buffalo sports? Are you thinking of changing loyalties and becoming a Buffalo sports fan? Do you even know where Buffalo is on the map? Did you know Canada is closer to Buffalo than New York City? Welcome to the Buffalo Huddle, every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time and 4 p.m. Pacific Coast Time on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. I'm your host, Patty Bax. This is a podcast designed for you, the passionate sports fan. I know you love your sports. Who doesn't? I cover Buffalo sports and so much more by bringing in the human elements. I call it Buffalo Sports with a Twist. Join me as we take a journey into the world of Buffalo sports. I guarantee you'll fall in love with Buffalo just like I did. Each week we start with an inspiration, question of the day, a Buffalo fun fact, and our weekly challenge to you, the listener. Come huddle up with me every Tuesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time and 4 p.m. Pacific Coast Time for the Buffalo Huddle with Patty Bax on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. As we say in Buffalo, go Bills!
That is right, ladies and gentlemen. IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We are back. My goodness, can we get a round of applause for our four awesome guests? Big shout out and thank you to all four of them. Mikey Two Guns, Patty Bax, as you just heard, our boy DC Kai, man, really cool dude, and Joey Jets, another really cool dude. That was a lot of fun. My goodness, we are halfway done with the AFC. Crazy, right? I mean, it just seems like, man, this always seems to fly by. Before you know it, it'll be next Thursday. I'll be back to work, gosh darn it. Just kidding. It'll be next Thursday. We'll be finishing the show. We'll be finishing the series. The Hall of Fame game will be that night. And we're full go into the preseason. We'll have some preseason shows. And then we're off into the real season, the regular season. So it is just so much fun doing this every year. I love doing this. It's just a lot of it's a lot of football that is needed. We had such a long offseason. This is just like the way to blow off all the football steam, you know? So anyway, guys, we are 3 hours in, and I promise I won't keep you much longer. But we ran our poll earlier today, and thank you to everybody who voted. Big ups to all of you. There's about 14 minutes left in this poll, but hey, we finished all of our interviews earlier. And at the moment, I don't know if it's going to change very much. But thank you to everybody who voted. 41% of you say that the Buffalo Bills are going to win the AFC East this season. 24 of you say that it'll be the Dolphins. Sorry, 24% of you will said it'll be the Dolphins. 21% of you said it'll be the Jets. And 14% of you said that it would be the Patriots. Okay. So here are my 1 through 4, and this was not easy. I don't want to catch no hate for this. I know fans from all four, and I feel horrible putting anybody at 4 or even at 3, but hey, someone's got to go there, right? And I just feel like right now, they're just based off of what I see and how I feel. Oh, this is a hard one. Kind of like yesterday. You know, I have a feeling the Raiders will probably be in the basement, but I'm just being biased, and I'm going to put them at third place because I don't want them to be in the basement. But realistically, they're probably going to be in the basement. Now, here, I could be biased as well. I got some big-time Patriots fans, close friends of mine. You know, my boy Alexander Gaines, and, of course, Mikey Two Guns and a lot of you out there, our boy Pete. But, unfortunately, I'm going to put them there. It's hard. I think this team will have a decent season. This is going to be a very, very good, I don't know. I feel like it's going to be a good go-around for all these teams facing each other. The Patriots may just eke out third. But you got to hear my reasoning. The quarterback situation, is Mac the guy? You know what I mean? Like, Zappy is there. I mean, do we really know who's going to play quarterback?
how well is that offensive line right now? Running backs, I mean, I don't know. They kind of messed up. They got some great receivers, but still, they messed up not getting D-Hop. I don't know. And the defense is pretty solid, but I don't know. I just don't see that defense carrying them across the finish line to a third or second. It's possible they could be third. It's a toss-up. And, well, I'm going to go with the Patriots being, and I know yesterday I didn't really throw the records out there because it's kind of pointless sometimes to throw out the records or just kind of give the amount of wins. But I kind of feel like right now the Patriots will come up on the rear, but it'll be a high rear. If I got to give a record, maybe 7-8 games on the low, maybe 9-10 on the high. But just because the quarterback situation and everything, you got to hear me out on that. It's hard to put them there, but I think the Pats might just send up for it this year. Now, the only reason is because of Aaron Rodgers. And there is my second or my third place team. Now, everyone's going to freak out. No, they got Rodgers. And I get it. But it's a first-year type of deal, guys. The same exact way I said with the Broncos under the Sean Payton regime. It's just, I can't necessarily say that this Jets team is going to be this flash out of nowhere and dominate and just, you know what I mean? Like, it's kind of hard. So, if they do, awesome. Thank you for proving me wrong. I've been wrong before. I've been wrong many times. But I've also been right, but I've also been wrong. You know what I mean? So, it's just, you know, opinions, gut feelings. But I just kind of felt like right now, the Jets, they'll have a pretty good year. And they will fight with, because the Patriots aren't out of this fight either. But I kind of feel like, and as you already know, you heard me, spoiler alert, you know, I'm taking the Bills to even be my Super Bowl favorite this year. So, of course, obviously, I have them taking first place in the AFC East. But I kind of feel like it really is a toss-up for third. The Patriots, man, this team could surprise the crap out of everybody with Bill and with what they got going right now. Especially Christian Gonzalez now playing defense over there. I don't know. The Patriots could surprise. At the same exact time, let's see what this offense can do with the Jets under Aaron Rodgers, you know, with him under center. And the same exact thing with the Dolphins. I just feel like the Dolphins are scary good. They got a lot of sleeper talent over there, like Jalen Ramsey. You know, I mean, they are a sleeper team, I mean, and they got a lot of talent. So I kind of feel like the Dolphins will make it happen, man. The Dolphins could totally get second place, as could the Jets, but the Patriots being that close third. I mean, I kind of feel like if it was like NASCAR or a race, I kind of feel it would sound like this across the finish line. It would be like the Bills going zoom, and then just third, second through fourth would be zoom, 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 like that. Like, I mean, seriously, like, and with that little gap in between, I felt like the Buffalo Bills will have a strong football team to win a lot of games. There might be a little gap between first and second, but the gap between second and fourth is going to be very slim. And that's just me also being hopeful for the Patriots. Some of you think the Patriots are going to completely fall off and nosedive. Some of you say the Bills are going to nosedive, and some of you say, I mean, a lot of you can say a lot of different things about who's going to nosedive or whatnot, but once again, guess my opinion, guys. That's all there is to it. Guess my opinion. I'm going to go with the Bills going pretty dominant and winning a lot of games. And then a close fight for a second. I'm going to go Dolphins, Jets, and then Patriots. So it's crazy. It's tough, you know, to put them in that order, especially after such a dominating performance the last two decades. I was going to say two seasons, but last two decades with the Patriots. But that's my thoughts. Those are my thoughts. That's how I feel that this thing will conclude. But, man, it is close. The Bills are just, I'm telling you guys, man, I don't know what it is. It's a lot happened last year for this team. And just the landing of Osiris now, it's so special to see what the Bills got going on over there. And they're playing with last year on their mind. And they're just, this team is going to be extremely hard to beat. I mean, I just can't see this team being anything but first place in the AFC East. I can't see them being anything but a first overall seed, and that would be over the Chiefs. And I don't know. Right now, I really feel like my Super Bowl is going to be the Bills and the Eagles. And honestly, I'm just going to say the Bills because I feel like they can have that extra oomph because of how much emotion they're going to be playing with this year, but the Eagles could totally win that game too. And once again, that's just, you know, at the moment, we know injuries happen, we know things happen, we know some teams can be duds coming into the season, and with all the hype surrounding, we know that, okay? But in my world right now, in my head, looking at the football season, I just feel like it would come down to those two teams. And, well, it will be a lot of fun to see them play, but, you know, on that stage. But anyway, those are my thoughts, my opinions, and that is going to do it. So, once again, thank you to everybody who voted on the voting poll, and thank you to everybody who tuned in. Man, that was a lot of fun, and, well, there's only one thing to do, y'all, and that's cue the music, because we're out of here! Alright, you guys, that was a lot of fun. My goodness. Another over 3 hour show. Yesterday was 3.5 hours, so today I'm glad it wasn't that long, but it was fun. We are now officially halfway through the AFC. I love doing this. This is so much fun. 8 divisions in 8 days, or the full title. 3 and out, 8 divisions in 8 days. AFC West is finished. The AFC East is finished. And coming up tomorrow, we have a really cool treat for you guys, as we are not only going to be talking about the AFC South, but we got 4. This is crazy. We got 4 people from the same exact podcast network, the Fan Battle Network, and they are going to be on. Every one of them is pretty cool. They cover all 4 teams in the AFC South, and it's going to be all 4 of them. That's pretty awesome, right? So I'm excited for that. The interviews are so much fun. These guys definitely have the rivalry. You can tell there's camaraderie there, but oh man, it's going to be a lot of fun. So tomorrow we are talking AFC South Colts, Texans, Titans, and Jaguars. This is going to be a great show, but today was a great show. Once again, thank you to all of our guests today, Mikey Two Guns, DC Kai, Joey Jets, and Patty Bax. Man, go give them all a follow. Check out all of their podcasts or their, of course, we got our Bleeping City with Mikey Two Guns here on IE Sports Radio, Patty Bax with Buffalo Huddle here on IE Sports Radio, and then you got Fins Up Kai, man, DC Kai with his YouTube channel. Check him out. And just Joey doing his thing on Twitter. So you heard all of their plugs. Check those guys out. Check all of them out. They're awesome guys and gal. And that's going to do it, you guys. Oh, man. Tomorrow, AFC South. Thursday, AFC North. Another great show lined up there. And that is going to do it. Follow us here on IE Sports Radio, everywhere on social media, TikTok, Twitter, or X now, I guess. Instagram, Facebook, and iSports Radio. You can follow me or boy Larry B at @thee_lb53 on Twitter as well, or X as well. Check out the show at 3 and out, IESR on X. And that is that, y'all. Oh, man. We are done. Once again, halfway through the AFC. Check out our website at iSportsRadio.com. Planet Jerky, big shout out to them. Follow them on Planet at Planet Jerky on Instagram. Check out our clothes, IESR Summer Sale 23 promo. Check out some of our merchandise on iSportsRadio.com. And that's going to do it, you guys. For me, your boy Larry B, I will see y'all tomorrow. Take care. And as always, God bless.